First World Order Radio. Finally, we are on the air. No doubt.
All right. There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Burr. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. Order. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics.
Radio.
Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.
We're back with Dr. Ali Mel Bay, First Water Radio. We got this occult, I guess you can say, teachings that we're going to be going over tonight, in particular the books. So we're going to go into a list of books. So we're going to bring on Brother L, my co-host. Brother L, are you here?
Hey, peace, God.
All right, peace, God. How you doing today?
Going very well. How you doing?
I'm doing well. All right, let's bring on Brother Penn. Brother Penn, are you here to get it started?
Yes, peace indeed, Almighty. What's going on, Dr. Lean L. Bay?
All right. Doing good, God. Doing good. How are you today?
Just chilly mostin. Old school.
All right. All right.
Brother L, how it do, Brother L? What's going on there?
Oh, very well, God.
Always a pleasure to hear.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
One of the things that's always a pleasure to hear.
Oh, yeah.
No, we're in a special Thursday night edition. First World Order Radio. So glad everyone could join us. I see the room is going to start to build up soon, as always. This is part two of a booklist show, probably one of the most beloved out each time this happens. I do them once a year at least, and some of the beloved offerings, because but I will say this, us conscious folks are quite interested in reading some of this information as opposed to just listening to it and playing around back and forth on Facebook. So, you know, when you get a show or information where, and as far as I know, within our circle, I have never seen any lecturer do this in one sitting, give out just a book list. There's been book lists that have been given out on certain subjects, certain areas, in a certain context, but just to give out just the entire show dedicated to books, I've never seen done. Now, in this show, for the first time on First World Order, we're going into heavy, heavy detail about each offering. And like I said, this is the second show. I'm not going to repeat the things I said in the first show, where we are in the situation where you can download the first show and hear it for yourself. Because most of the foundation work that I dealt with in the first show will make this show easily understandable. And you must hear that foundation work so you not only understand the importance of books, the type of books that you will read or come across in the occult study. You need to really understand the context in which we should be reading these books in the first place. One of the lines that I talked about last week was, nothing in existence is greater than the black woman or the black man's mind. So therefore, there will be never a book, not one book, that you will ever come across that will supersede your own thought, intuition, and knowing. The only thing these books can do is to serve, well, first and foremost, understand that every book on this planet in creation is nothing more than a bad explanation of the black man or the black woman. So therefore, you being the source, always anything in the book. The best thing you can do is read them to help you remember or put certain scholarly, intellectual things together, but always have in mind that you need to go past the intellect into having the experience. So because we are now born and raised in an intellectual paradigm or reality, we now cannot ignore the intellect as something we need to satisfy. Not raise up, not cultivate, in my opinion, but something that we need to satisfy. So therefore, when things do come across your table in this in your magical journey that defies logic, and remember that's your ultimate goal, to defy logic, because if it's logical, that means it's normal, and if it's normal, that means it's no longer magical. The idea of magic or the concept is that you're doing something that supersedes the normal logical thinking. So us trying to make everything that happens so it's logical defeats the purpose. So your goal is to tap into something that defies logic. And when this happens, ultimately it will happen because you have the original substance to do that. What you need to do to satisfy that, or what will help you along this magical process, is if you're able to trace what is illogical to its logical origin. Not necessarily make it logical, but to explain something that is illogical to somebody who's still in a logical, who needs the logical framework to actually have that extra, that magical experience. You need to be able to give them foundation information or logic. So in other words, when I tell you something that's what would be considered magical or irrational or extra-worldly beyond humanity about Mayat, at the same time, because I read just so many books about her, I'm able to explain to that same person when they hear this and go, oh my goodness, panic, that is just so insane, I'm able to also say, well, read a book on this and read a book on that and see what happens to you. So in other words, my mentality is not to explain what happened to me through that book. My mentality is to explain a foundation or a beginning path for someone to eventually walk their way to an experience that is also magical. This is the mentality that we need to adapt. These books are not here to supersede anything magical or what can happen in your own mind, only to back up and reinforce the logical aspect that is now necessary and needed as foundation.
Right.
And I went through this hard, and I'm saying this hard because I've heard debates, you know, black people talking about we need to go past the books and I'm beyond the books and the books don't mean nothing and white people wrote the books. White people are excellent for writing books because they have nothing else imaginative. So since they have nothing else imaginative to add, all they can deal with is with pure logic, facts and research. They are absolute fact and research being, not because they're special, because they have nothing else to add. See, if you ask Oprah to do this type of research, it won't be long for her Negro-ness is injected in the situation, and she'll be talking her own shit. You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And you don't necessarily want that, because in this particular study, we're trying to create our own shit. So we don't need to base our own shit on some other black person's own shit, because we have the mechanism to take information and add imagination to it. So white people do not have that level of imagination. So they're the best at writing logical books, because they have nothing to add that can take you – they have nothing of their own to add. They're only regurgitating your science. So they are the perfect ones to write a book. So while you're sitting there, a white man wrote that, he doesn't have nothing to lie about. See, the lies come in, which are not really lies. It's just people's own perspective, and we've done lectures on perspective. But you're not looking for perspective in when you're looking for source information in your study. You're not looking for perspective. You're looking for plain information so you can create your own perspective based upon information. See, source information would be Rodney King getting his ass beat. Perspective would be white people saying, well, he was trying to get up. And black people were saying, this is that old familiar slavery that we know, that old familiar genocide and abuse that we know. But white people said he was trying to get up and he was menacing and he shouldn't have been in a Hyundai. That's perspective. But the source information is the one tape that we've seen that's absolute fact. See, when white people do their thing, they cannot add perspective in this context, because they cannot speculate past what it is they're actually teaching, because they cannot experience it.
Mm-hmm.
They cannot speculate on melanin, no matter what code name they use, because they don't have enough of it to have had an experience. But see, if we heard source information about melanin, something in us will relate it to something that we do know, because we have been doing it, we have been actualizing it. Therefore, you may hear a story or two that's not necessarily necessary for you to hear when black people are actually writing. Not to say that just because they're a black person, they cannot be logical, stick to source information and the facts. You know, in the occult, you'll find black people do that, because that's the order of the day. But I'm just trying to give you a general understanding of why you shouldn't be sweating that white thing so much. And if you know, if you really know the science, they're actually here working for us, and that's why they are writing our books, to remind us of what it is that's inside of us that we're trying to raise up. So when we left off, I was about to drop a whole bunch of magic books on you.
Right.
Generalized books that you will find from Botanica to Botanica about magic. Voodoo, folklore, folk magic. We went through a lot of the dark magic understanding. Most of these books are about folk magic. And that's pretty much the culture of magic in general. You get these items, as I pointed out, from a place called a botanica. Most botanicas are in most major cities and most major hoods. If you don't know where a botanica is by you, by all means, go up on Google, look for botanica to find one near you. If you can't find one near you, then look for a botanica online. This is important because as you get into the books that I'm about to give out to you, and there's many more like it that you will find, a lot of items that are needed in rituals have folk, what they call folk names, nicknames basically, that they use constantly. So you'll see the same nicknames used over and over again. We use High John the Conqueror. Now, High John the Conqueror has a herb, is an actual herb, and you can look it up and find what it is, but it doesn't grow out the ground as High John the Conqueror. Someone named this herb High John. You get what I'm saying? and you'll find this comes up. So where do you get this? Where can you get these things where you find these folk names would be Botanicus. When I was reading these books, I'm hearing all these names. I'm like, where the fuck am I going to find this? A Johnny Rock and a Lodestone and Fruit of the Earth oil and everything was at Botanicus. If they didn't have it, they could get it. So you need to make yourself familiar with that if you plan on doing magical work. All right. I literally just came in from the farmer's market, dialed in momentarily, so I'm trying to scarf down this shit before we get before we start getting busy. So you niggas hear me chewing. Get over it. All right. A good book was called Egyptian Magic, The Forbidden Secrets of Ancient Egypt by Joseph Toledano, D-O-L-E-D-A-N-O. This was a pretty good book because he took some of the most famous symbols or standard symbols that we constantly see over and over, like the buckle of Isis and things like that, and gave out rituals that you could do with these standard symbols that we know all the time. He also, you know, broke down what he did was overall in his book take all the standard Egyptian stuff and kind of gave it put it more in an active magical context where there were things you could actually do with these symbols that were more closely related to folk magic, maybe even ritual magic, and maybe even ceremonial magic. So closer to what we know is that, he added an Egyptian flair to that, which was pretty good. So most people are just studying Egypt, or Kemite, whatever you want to call it, and calling it at that, maybe the deities are doing some work. But he took some of the symbols and was able to give you a magical apparatus in it. So it was a pretty good book. Egyptian Magic, the Forbidden Secrets of Ancient Egypt by Joseph Toledano, T-O-L-E or Toledano, T-O-L-E-D-E-D-A-N-O. Another good book, The Black Plate, P-U-L-L-E-T. Hold on, let me get this for you. This is a magical book. This is one of the standards I would say too. It's really about black magic. It's an old book, Magic Death, in like the 18th century. About $13. You go into rituals, talismans. Okay. Room was pretty good. It was all right. It was probably, if you never dealt with magic, it's a good book. It's one of those starter books for someone trying to get and understand magic, like I explained how Constantinos was. But this was a good one for dark magic, and like I said, they go to sigils and so on and so forth. Another book, Voodoo and Hoodoo by Jim Haskins. Just a good book to have. I had this a long time ago. He does give out classic voodoo and hoodoo rituals. I think he talks a little bit about the differences in voodoo and hoodoo. Hoodoo is more folklore. I think voodoo is more religified. Hoodoo is more folklore. So he gives a nice little history on the culture also. But then he goes into a lot of get this oil for that, get this stone for that. And he puts a couple of rituals for lovers and this, that, and the other. I'll just give it out. This is actually one of Khadijah's books, I think. Yeah, because the same. Well, let me see. What is this? If it's mine, I don't remember buying this. So this must be one of Khadijah's books. And but it looks good. The Witch's Magical Handbook. Why I'm giving it out because it's by an author that I do know is badass, Yvonne Frost. She also made an Astro Trap book. We'll get up to it with her husband, Gavin Frost. But they're good. They're on point. They're simple writers, and they're good. So, I do recommend them. And this is a Witch's Magical Handbook. I think this is Khadijah's. So let me read the Table of Context, see what's in it. The Web of the World, Mind Keys, Examples of Psychic Healing, Avoid Unwelcome Surprises. So it seems like she's doing good. You'll get what you need. Urgent Necessity. But it sounds like just one of them standard good books. Like I said, the way she wrote in the other book is one of those things you can't get wrong if you got the money to do it. Let me go on and get these reading glasses and stop acting like I'm better than that. Alright, put these shits on. Looking like real old right now. Alright. You can get this book. Very good book. Black and White Magic by Marie Laveau. It's out of print. And in it, this is a whole little one of those Botanica books. It's by Original Publications. And it has all of Marie Laveau's rituals in here. So just standard shit. Love, enemy, friends, so on and so forth. She does give a little bit of information. Hearts, diamonds, and little divination information. But an excellent book on some of her rituals. And this is straight Marie Laveau's information. This is a book with her straight rituals in there. And y'all should know who Marie Laveau is.
Oh, yeah.
Y'all should know her now because Angela Bassett has been playing her on that TV show.
Yeah, right. I asked about that last time we had the show, and they had cut us off. And I was wondering, Angela Bassett really knew what she was doing when she was portraying her?
No, I would say hell to the no, because Angela Bassett is a devout Christian. And she's big time. You know, damn near. Did you know Jesus is your personal Lord and Savior, Christian? And so is Denzel, actually. So is Denzel.
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah. So, but, you know, like any actor, they justify what they do by saying they're deep in the role. But I knew I knew that Marie Laveau shit wasn't happening in because when she did it, she made sure she got that movie out in Nativity. So she did a whole Jesus movie during this time just to say, no. I'm playing a role.
Mm-hmm.
And she's playing the shit out that role now.
Okay.
But, she's letting herself go in the role. But now, understand this. If you understand basic training that actors go through,
right?
They become this vessel. That's why... I mean, it's clear. This nigga became Ray Charles. This nigga became Denzel became Malcolm X, and you know, and if we think harder. These niggas been taking over when they got them roles. I this is on my mind because black people in the conscious community had this debate about Django, and you know, I came out since I've seen that shit. It's probably the most fucking magical movie in Hollywood. In the last fucking 5 to 10 fucking years.
Mm-hmm.
Hands fucking down. Hands down. Niggas talking about the ancestors wouldn't appreciate. Y'all niggas is lost shit. Y'all niggas is just fucking mind control. And then if you think I'm kidding, they gave you 42, the butler, and Mandela just to get your ass back in line after Django. They gave you four fucking slave, subservient, bullshit-ass movies just to counteract that Django shit, and 12 Years a Slave.
Mm-hmm.
Four movies just to counteract the one movie of Django. And it's not the details of Django that matter. It's the fucking psyche. First and foremost, you've never seen a slave that aggressive. You've never seen a black man in any fucking film dominate the white man who was supposed to, like, see, they usually get you off because the white man comes up. See, take, for instance, 42, which I just watched. Is the Jackie Robinson story.
Mm-hmm.
In it, they had Harrison Ford say, I'm going to get a black man on the team. Oh, you're going to be ridiculed. You're going to be that. So they subtly, we look at Jackie Robinson as the hero, but psychologically, they're showing you that he could not even begin to be a hero until the white man set his heroism in motion.
Exactly.
Which dominates. Which he's still putting himself in the role of the dominant. So you say, well, Jackie Robinson, he was a hero. We know what it is. He's 42. He sacrificed. They were spitting on him and threw balls at him with a hero. But the backstory is this white man is actually orchestrating this, pulling the string. So they're telling you your civil rights, the victory that you held on to with your self esteem of him being the first anything, which is an oxymoron. Black people being the first anything. The only thing we're the first is the first fucking anything on this planet is the only title of first. There's no first black lawyer, first none of that. We invented this shit. You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
We invented this shit. See, the real deal is nobody wants to watch fucking baseball without niggas. They were losing. How do you know? Because imagine watching any sports event with just white people now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Imagine watching basketball. I don't watch no sports, but imagine watching basketball with all white people. No fucking body would want to see that shit.
No.
Before there was a first black anything in sports, that's what they were doing. So you know the shit was getting corny. It was just the standard back then. So it wasn't like they said niggas broke through because we were begging to get in. We had our own leagues. They said, God damn, but this is where the action's at. We need to put niggas in this shit so we can survive. And that's what it is. But they're not going to tell you that history is like, I'm a brave man, and he tells the story that they threw this other Negro out, and he was so touched by this other Negro. That's why he got Jackie Robinson in, and that's why he's doing it, and he's the fighter and all this. It really made the white man look like the hero. All fantasistic bullshit. While in the movie Django, what they had was this white guy who had all the strings, but then they actually showed Django making all the moves. And when they got down south, Django actually took control and rescued his bitch. So I was at least saying, well, okay, if Django's going to be the slave and rescue his bitch, you know, at least, and I figured at least, well, the white man's going to be telling him how to get it done. But that wasn't the case. So psychologically, that's where the breakthrough was with Django, beyond what you've seen on screen. He called him a nigger. He beat him. He jumped up and cut his throat. Okay, that's all outward dramatic shit. Okay, yay, you want to see that. You know, when he shoot that white lady and shot out her shoes, that's all magical. But you're talking about his dominance was absolutely unseen. So they have to shut that psychological breakdown down. Because now they say this may create a trend. You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
A trend. See, because, and if you think I'm kidding, there was a movie, or the first black movie was that came out by a black director from a black perspective was called Sweet Sweetback by Melvin Van Peebles, son of father of Mario Van Peebles. And this was embraced by the Black Panthers, and that's all she wrote. And the story is about a black man who's fed up and turns on the cops and tears them a new asshole. He's that dude. He becomes that dude. This became the template for Shaft, then eventually Superfly, Dolomite, Trouble Man, and those blaxploitation movies with every black man kicking ass, take Chuck Turner, anything Fred Williamson has done. But what Melvin Van Peebles was, he was fighting against white folks. They eventually went all the way down the line until the shit became Superfly. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
The same nigga, but, oh, he's just a drug dealer now.
Right.
Ex-pimp now. And he's honorable because he's trying to get out the game, but he's really not about shit.
No,
and
he's
then,
not.
And they all became cops later on. Before it was against the man, now he's working with the man. Even though he kicks ass and has some white hoes, he's still working with and for the man.
Mm-hmm.
So they just made this. So they had to go the long route of taking what Sweetback broke through and change the face of America, this particular hero. They had to go the long route of taking it and started to water it down. So now they have they went in early to water down Django. They went in early. They said the butler becomes the hero.
Right.
Then 12 Years a Slave becomes the hero. You
right.
really get nothing. You really it's a true story. He really gets nothing done. What and they actually did this story before. Avery Brooks played the lead role before
right.
in the 80s. And the story is about black man who was free for quite some time, played the fucking fiddle. And two white people ask him, well, I need you to play the fiddle at some recital or some place. He's like, no, I don't want to do it. They paid him, got him to do it. When they did it, the nigga, they slipped a Mickey in his motherfucking drink. Nigga woke up on the chain gang. I don't believe this. This is just there's got to be a mistake here. You know, he did that for like a fucking 45 minutes in the movie, and ultimately he went through the whole slave thing, right? And ultimately his people finally found them. It's against the law. They came with the law, which I don't even fucking get. It's lawful for him to be free, but everybody else that they kidnapped, it's unlawful. They did that same shit in Amistad. Wait. These particular niggas, it's against the law. But every other nigga that you stole, it's all good. You know what I'm saying? I don't. I don't even get that fucking insane logic they have. So they free him. He goes back. Then he writes the book, 12 Years a Slave. So he was in slavery for 12 years. So and that's all they have. He just write the book. They don't even know, because there's nothing else in his writing about the future. So that very story is what they found in writing. So it's a true story. So basically, when you see it, it comes to that same thing that we've been doing the whole time. Spike Lee and everyone is guilty of. They're not taking our Holocaust situation and doing things to turn it around in any way. What they're doing is revisiting our Holocaust and just reminding you of how bad it was. You get what I'm saying? So if Spike Lee would have did Django, all we would have seen is all the tragedy, and
right.
you would have just still walked out the movie feeling that you're a victim.
Right.
You walked out of Django feeling like, God, at least this motherfucker kicked somebody's ass and got his bitch back. Fantasy or whatever, but the only way it becomes a reality, if you can see it in your psyche. So when you see black people making these movies, it shows you the state of their psyche. They cannot see it. They see themselves as the never-ending slave. Just little things we say go a long way. For instance, I was watching the Essence Image Awards, which is a fucking carnival. I only get through it like a 45 minutes before I just turned on some other bullshit. And but Anthony Anderson says, you know, we're doing great now, black folks are this, black folks are that. We're the bomb now, we're the shit. We started from the bottom, and now we're here. There's no statement that is more untrue than black folks starting from the bottom. It's still in the psyche that we started as slaves. We ran this place for millions of years. What our genocide here on Earth is big to us because we're going through it now, and really us on the tail end of it. That's why it's big now. But in the in the total package of what we are, this really even isn't a hiccup. This really isn't a blink of an eye to how long we was on top here. You get what I'm saying? So a statement we started from the bottom is the mentality they need to keep alive. So when you see a character like Django, even they don't have to go into his origin, but just from where he stands in the movie, as you see, it says that he has a history greater than what we've come to accept as our normalcy. That's why it was so many psychological things about that movie that was so fucking dangerous. It says when you see Django and even the other slaves, and even when they, when in the beginning when they killed that white man, he said he was calling what was he calling that one nigga? He was calling a nigga. He said, "Didn't I give you my last apple, nigga?" You know what I'm saying? These niggas just murdered this nigga. See, the movies we see even being victimized, it seems we're a victim from the beginning point of this time. When you see these guys have something in them that's greater than just the submitted Negro, Fiddler, it says that they have a greater origin. This was also shown in Roots, when they showed the niggas in America totally submitted. But the whole point of that story was Kunta Kinte, who they showed his African origin. So they showed that they were showing that he had a history before he got here. And with that history comes his rebellious nature.
Right.
Up until you cut off that nigga's foot, then totally be good, nigga, master for master.
Mm-hmm.
That's when you don't want to watch it no more.
Right.
Now, but see, they're not shooting for the obvious. They're shooting for the psychological. So when I seen Django, I said, oh, not only did the obvious make sense, because the obvious would be just a black man with a tough stick. They did that before. That was Shaft. I'm going to kick your ass, honky. Back up, sucker. That went so far, but you kind of knew that was just a movie. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Foxy Brown, you white trash, dirty, rotten, honky suckers. You said, oh, man, I love it. Yay. But then you knew you went back to your fucking job sweeping. Yes, sir, Mr. Charlie. And all that kind of stuff. So you knew that's the only way you could express yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So now when you see Django, it tells a greater story based upon his rebelliousness, his willing to rebel, and the heroic acts that you've seen him do. You get what I'm saying? You ain't never
right.
seen a black man walk on the plantation, take a whip out of a white man's hand, tell the other slave, I want y'all to see this, and whip the shit out of him. That's the best shit I've ever seen on a motherfucking screen. So,
like you said before, the butler and 12 Years of Slaves was made to water that down.
They're made to water that down.
Mm-hmm.
Now you have Mandela, which is another illusion, because when we were getting all excited about Obama, there was a South African who said, you know something? We fell for that same shit that you're about to go through. Give him
mm-hmm.
a black president, and
mm-hmm.
you think the whole world's going to change. Nothing's really changed but your self-esteem and your ego. Same shit here. Nothing's really changed but your self-esteem and your ego. So I didn't see the Mandela, but I already heard it said, well, we had to show that he was a flawed man. So you already know they got some bullshit going on. You know what
mm-hmm.
I'm saying? They do it all the time. They take our genius, shut it down. Frankie Lyman's story, you know what I'm saying? They show Frankie Lyman as a fucking addict. Didn't even deal with the genius of his music in that movie. And his music is fucking genius. And so was his brother, Louis Lyman. And, you know, Ray Charles, you know they're going to see him smack the fuck out. You know what I'm saying? Of course. You know what I mean? Even though they played his music, you know what I'm saying? You can't escape the genius of Ray Charles. Most people don't know who Frankie Lyman was, but I was a
mm-hmm.
Frankie Lyman fan at a child because he was a pan energy. He was a child genius. The year he died was the year I was born, and around the time he died is when the Jackson started blowing up, which was Michael Jackson. And I did all this work in the channel. Frankie Lyman was a pan energy that rolled up, and after his death, his energy went into little Michael Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so we need to understand, we need to look at things a little bit more deeper than the obvious. You know what I'm saying? Avatar wasn't about the white man helping. It wasn't about a love story between white and black people. It was about the white man rescuing your ass. That's more psychological. You got to look at the psychic. You got to look like the outward, and you got to look at the subconscious impact. The psychological story that they're telling.
Yeah, the psychological story that they're telling, that they rescued us from savagery civilized us.
See, right, no matter what we did to y'all,
we civilized y'all. You know,
right, no matter what was coming down the pipe, the one white man comes and everything is changed in order, and they cannot do these things without him. Fucking ancestor tree ain't talked for billions of years until they started, he got there. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Now, there is a spiritual aspect to that. On the surface, we're going to say all of that white stuff. There is a spiritual aspect to that, but it's not really white people. And I'm going to give you the example of a black situation that does it as well. But what they're trying to get at, see, like, if we are Nigerian people, and we're in the Nigerian culture, so every child that's born is going to be routinely brought up the same way. Therefore, with that being said, there's nothing that inspires change. So when something or a child is born that's odd and or not normal to the cultural routine, that child becomes special and becomes changed for that culture.
Mm.
So white people have been trying to take on this role that there's just been billions of black people doing what black people do on the planet, even though it's high energy, it's the same energy, until they come in and inject a difference or that chaos factor or that change factor, that's when shit begins to change. Now, this is not a white standard. This is the role they're trying to take on. Because mm-hmm. the prime example of that would be Shaka Zulu. They were the Zulu people, they were routine, but Shaka Zulu was born and he changed the way they dealt with war. He changed the spear, the way they did this thing. In other words, to the culture, he was a pain in the ass.
Mm-hmm.
But to this day, they're still doing his military strategy to this day, because he inspired that change in the culture. So now that's what they're trying to portray, that there's always this white guy, like you doing rap music, but then a white guy comes and he does it awkwardly,
mm-hmm.
but it's okay. Somehow working, you know what I mean? So outwardly, we keep seeing this story of white people coming in. We couldn't figure it out until they came. But there's a metaphysical aspect. I don't think most of them are tapping into that or even going for that. They're going for the outward shit. But sometimes you can watch a picture, and it's the chaos. The white person represents that chaos factor, that change that fucks it up.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes you got to eat a Snicker bar to know to fuck up your diet to be able to get back to something. You know what I'm saying? If you're always in perfect health, there's no you cannot get more perfected than the perfect health you're in until
right.
you get something fucked up in your system. So it's that kind of mentality. All right, so back to the books. There's another good book called Voodoo, Charms and Talismans by Robert Pelton, Pelton. So this is a good voodoo book, a lot of rituals. How to raise a man's sperm count, how to prevent losses, stop jealousy, avoid injuries, overcome legal problems, break a hex, anything you possibly need, and it gives you the rituals. Again, they use that dialogue from, Botanicas. So when you hear the ingredients that they're asking for, you know you get them from Botanicas. Voodoo Rituals, a User Guide by, it looks like, Haki Owusu, Haikeowusu. And again, just more books on voodoo ritual. But he does talk about different elements, air creatures, fairies, demons, vampires, classic vets, and their actual roles and what they do, fire elements, water elements, telepathy, magic mirrors, trance, lantern, kettles, incense burning, challenge, clairvoyance, the wand, the sword, the belt, clothing, serpent magic, dog magic, zombies, you know, fetishes and so on and so forth, initiation and, you know, and so on and so forth, the loa, the gate, and he's snake movement and blah, blah, blah. So this book I believe to be absolutely excellent for someone starting out and need to get a clear understanding on these definitions and the differences. See, there are differences between the charm, seal, talisman, amulet, and all of these things, in a sigil. There are actual differences. So I don't know if they're in that book. There, I teach that in my class, and, with good reason. But you know, these particular things you want to learn. But this type of book here goes to a lot of different definitions, because once you understand these definitions, a lot of what you see or have been seen around you becomes clearer. Another good book is Egyptian Magic by E.A. Wallace Budge. This is a Budge book. It's pretty good. This is one where he does give out rituals with classic Egyptian items as well. You know, his whole thing is Egyptian, so he goes through some of the old Egyptian rituals, but he'll deal with, you know, like, but his is more basic, like, rituals and things to do with a scarab, and things to do with this, and things to do, you know, like that. So it's pretty good. Another good book by an author that you can pretty much get anything by her on this subject. She deals heavy with Santeria and Ifa, primarily from the Santeria perspective. Ifa is the African origin, the later day version of Ifa, when the saints got injected into the religion. The slaves merged the saints with the Orishas, and it became Santeria. And so she, one of her books is called Rituals and Spells of Santeria. It's Magente Gonzalez Whipler is her name. I thought it was a guy, but the guy is spelled M-I-G-E-N-E. Middle G-O-N-Z-A-L-E-S hyphen W-I-P-P-L-E-R. Magente Gonzalez Whipler. And, you know, she just gives out all the standard spells that you will find in Santeria using the Orishas, so Babaluae, Olokun, and all these guys have standard spells. She gives them out, the warriors, necklaces. She does a lot of explaining too. And she's dealing with a lot of the minor Orishas, Inlay, Dada, and all of them as well, as opposed to just the main. I see some Oya and Ochosi stuff, Ogun, Babaluaye. She's explaining it. She's one of the ones that explains stuff real easy and right to the point. All right, like I said, my books are mixed up. This is a book that you must have, Melanin, A Key to Freedom by Richard King, M.D. Richard King is our brother. He's a brother that has spoke and was connected to the conscious circuit. He made the transition, I think, late 2013. We gave a shout-out to him here on the show when he did make the transition. Richard King is the premier scholar on melanin for conscious folks. Basically, before Richard King, even though you would find books on melanin and how it relates to a more metaphysical aspect, you will find more of that using code names for melanin. But when we got right down to it, as a conscious person who understood our language, who talked to us, Richard King was that person, MD. And in his book, Melanin, Key to Freedom, he goes through melanin and how it relates to the common Negro. It's basically how it shows up in the body, the more why we are superior based upon melanin. So he has melanin in the eye, melanin in the ear. He's why you see more. You ever see a white person even look? They look at the sun and they blink 1,000 times. You ever see a white person and they can't even look at you because they're actually seeing the sun in you. They can't look you directly in the eye. Some white people can't even look you directly in the eye because they're actually seeing the sun in you. It's like looking directly into the sun.
Exactly.
We hear detail in music more. That's why. That's because of melanin in the ear. We see more of the color spectrum. That's melanin in the eye. Melanin in the brain, neuromelanin, brainstem melanin. He goes into that detail. This is in the context of his book. And because of neuromelanin, we feel pain more intensely. That's why you ever see a white person that fighting Irish in the boxing ring is not because they're tough or tougher than you. It's because they actually have no neuromelanin. So when they get punched in their face, the melanin is not sending the signal to their brain that they have been punched in their face as hard as they have.
Mm-hmm.
So it's actually a deficiency why they could stand there and get their face pounded in the hamburger meat, and why you look like, why you could get punched and be like, okay, the fight's over, because for you, you get punched, and because of your superior melanin, you get the signal quicker and you're in more pain. In fact, because of your melanin, that's why you get addicted quicker. These things on this planet affect you quicker because of your melanin, and that's why they're slow at everything, including dancing. Shit, your melanin is why you have motherfucking rhythm, and your rhythm is lined up with cosmic movement. Please believe that shit. Everything in existence moves in a rhythm. You are connected to that rhythm. Rhythm is called Ra's hymn, the song of the sun. In fact, the sun is where we get, look, the sun is primarily where we get our your funky-ass dance moves from. Carl Jung, which I talked about last week as opposed to Sigmund Freud, he talks about something called the collective unconscious, meaning that folks have their personal unconscious mind, and then there's the collective unconscious. So now, if you were to talk about your personal unconscious mind, that will be how you feel about slavery and not even knowing. Somebody may say something to you and you might go right in the slave mode, not even realizing shit. You ever be at your job and say some slave shit and catch yourself? Yes, sir, right away. Oh, wait a minute. You're just doing that shit, don't even know, whistling and shit while you sweeping. Let me cut this bullshit out. You know what I'm saying? Well, yes, sir, right away. Coming right up, sir. And you know, you had to catch the tone. That was some unconscious shit right there that you don't even realize because it's deep. It became programmed based upon Willie Lynch, deep in the DNA. That may be personal, and it may surface, and because you're a conscious person or an aware person for that level, you may catch yourself. And then you meet that nigga on your job who's doing that shit. They ain't got no problem with you.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? You want to punch that nigga in his face because he's fucking it up for everybody. I'll do it, give it to me.
Most definitely.
I sure like to be here. Yes, sir, boss and stuff. Yes, sir, Mr. Boss. And don't even know he's doing it wrong. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And then when you ask him a question, get it the fuck away from me, nigga. Then the boss, okay, I'm coming right up. Which is, oh, I'm drinking some delicious coffee today. Delicious coffee. I'll come up with a whistle. Oh, wait a minute. I think I want to dance for a dance or jig or some kind of shit. Now, that's just a nigga in a nigga's unconscious. Now, there's something called the collective unconscious. And the collective unconscious is the movement of black folks collectively. So if I'm even telling you a story, I said, well, do that for Ganesha. That's going to help you personally. But then if I say I got a channel from Trayvon and what we need to do as a people, for conscious people, start eating these grapes or do that or refrain from that or get into that, that's a collective ritual that we'll do. something that benefits us all. You get what I'm saying? While there may be something that may benefit you personally. So we, first of all, understand there's two different things. Now, the collective unconscious moves collectively. It moves like how you could say everyone, all the chicks in Atlanta have a certain vibe. All the chicks in New York have a certain vibe. All the people in Atlanta sound a certain mm-hmm. way. All the people in Canada sound a certain way. Because
right.
collectively, or collectively, unconsciously, they talk, move, act, and interpret information in some way just based upon living together, thinking together, and coming up with a collective unconscious mentality. Therefore, when they see something, it stimulates them differently. That's why when Michael Moore does his shows about healthcare and asks niggas in America, what do you feel about healthcare, and everybody's face shriveled up, then they go to Canada and they're like, shit, it's free, nigga. We go right now. Because they've never had to deal collectively like we had to do with healthcare. See, collectively, you had an aunt who couldn't get that, your pops who couldn't get that, you couldn't get your teeth fixed when you wanted to get fixed. So that adds to our psyche as a group of people, and it forms our collective unconscious. Now, if you look at the metaphysical aspect of it, of the collective unconscious, it's always evolving. The things we do help it to evolve. Us as conscious folks just putting out our information, talking what I'm talking, studying what I'm studying, we are changing the collective unconscious. You ever notice that more Christians are now starting to deal non-effectively or minor with more conscious information now?
Mm-hmm.
The mere fact that Beyonce's in the Baphomet, which is excellent, when you get past your church understanding of what's sinister, means somewhere along the line, black people who are not into nothing but transformation are using alternative methods or occult methods to accomplish their goal.
Mm-hmm.
This is because us as conscious folks are injecting into the unconscious collective of black folk psyche, which they all connected through the DNA, Akasha, in the ether, and melanin. You understand? So by us just doing the work, we injected. You ever hear motherfucking Prince was on the talk show talking about chemtrails? You understand what I'm saying? So collectively and unconsciously, what we do is add to the collective unconscious. So you got Richard King. When he put out this book, after his book, you had what they had, and I can name 10 lectures that we know and enjoy, and now our standards are scholars under the umbrella of Richard King's melanin study. That's how popular it is. So injecting this into the psyche eventually changes the unconscious collective of us, or adds to that, or by us studying it, will change it. Now, one of the ways that spirit communicates with the unconscious collective is through dance and rhythm and through the sun. What happens when we stand in the sun? You get a suntan.
Right.
What's a suntan? It's the deeper melanin coming into the surface of your skin. The
mm-hmm.
logical, rational explanation, well, it's coming to protect you from the ultraviolet rays. But no. It may be doing that, but the spiritual aspect of the melanin that now has surfaced from deep within and radiates on your skin is now surfaced to receive a message that is transferred on the light of the sun. If you watch the movie K-Pax said, we travel through light. So the ancestors' messages are traveling through light. How come you think every nigga want to be at a cookout standing in the sun all the fucking time? They communicate through the sun, through the melanin. So when you get a tan, the melanin rolls up to hear an ancestral message that speaks to the unconscious, the collective unconsciousness. And the messages that they send are through dance. That's why, how come on the East Coast, niggas can be doing a dance called a Patty Duke, and they're doing the same shit on the West Coast. They do it on the West Coast, eventually gets to the East Coast. It was dance that was the Rock, the Freak, the Patty Duke, the Smurf, the Jerry Lewis, the Michael Jackson, the Pop-Tart, nigga, the Hot Pants, the Penguin, the Funky Chinkin, you know what I'm saying?
Exactly. There you go.
The Dastardly Duck, because that was the messages of the ancestors, because by doing these dances, you position yourself just like hieroglyphs. You change the body into an antenna that receives higher cosmic messages.
Yeah,
well, y'all niggas going to hear me on the book list tonight.
Because
I just kind of in the mood to tell this kind of shit. You change yourself into a hieroglyph that receives, which is making your body an antenna to receive higher cosmic message from the realm of the ancestors to line us up with the new hot evolution. This is manifested in the collective unconsciousness through fashion. That's why niggas start wearing the same shit, through slang, through music, and through dance, which white folks ain't caught up with none of that shit yet. They doing what we do. Get it right. They ain't come up with no new slang. Their hottest shit is dude. But don't forget this. Dude was ours in the beginning. Niggas forgot that shit. We made up dude. What up, dude? We made up dude. Fucking Quincy Jones got an album, Check Out the Dude. Before it became dude. You know what I'm saying? It was What Up, Dude? Before it became dude. So dude ain't even theirs. You know what I'm saying? So all that shit is ours. They ain't got no slang. We make up all the slang.
Right.
Every music form, that's the best they have shown in music. That's the best foot they put forward. And even their music has an origin with Negro music. It's still our lead. It's still what we create. They're still imitating us. But like anything else, they can it begins as an imitation, then they have to, it's just custom fit to their lifestyle and to speak, communicate to them. You know what I'm saying? Because we don't eat jelly sandwiches. They do. But it was originally peanut butter and jelly. You know what I'm saying? Now, fashion, that's all us. All us. We've done the dumbest shit in the world, begin to take their fashion and act like it's what's hot. But it's really dumb shit. But they've gassed us up into that. But I've done things on that. I'll tell you this. Those of you who are free enough, watch a movie called Paris is Burning. It is the gayest movie you will ever see. But I had a gay cousin. I had a gay cousin, and this movie was out of print. And their brother was in it, who died AIDS in the 90s. And
That was a war movie, wasn't it?
It was a documentary.
Okay.
Paris is Burning, a documentary. Okay. And they wanted to see their brother. Their brother was dead. And I said, well, if I ever see it, because I'm a movie collector. So I went to the store. They had it for rent. But I never rent a movie. I said, well, I want to buy this. He said, no, we can't. It's out of print. I said, well, any idea where you could get it? The guy said, well, they used so much music that they couldn't get cleared, so it's not out for sale. I said, oh, okay. I didn't even tell my cousins because, you know, we got their hopes up high. But boom, lo and behold, I was coming out the house. The spirit said, I was on my way to work. I was still working at the record label at this time. And the spirit said, go to Virgin Records. Went to Virgin Records, sure enough, the movie was there. Got it. I said, I'm going to go to their house. I'll be a hero. They'll be watching their brother tonight. You know, I had no idea how gay this movie was. Then, you know, sure enough, went home. Oh, shit, oh, shit. Now, we watching it. Only like, that faggot's dead. I didn't know this. This shit was straight up about voguing and all of this shit. So now I'm stuck watching this goddamn shit. You know what I'm saying? So, but I'm watching it. And first of all, at least 40% of the niggas in the movie, they remembered, and they was like, this nigga's dead, that nigga's dead, this nigga's dead, that nigga's dead. That was almost like the national anthem of the movie. They seen their brother, they was happy, I gave them the movie. Now, The next night when I go to sleep, I hear this nigga coming through. And you know, I'm sitting there like, oh, shit, nigga. This is the communication I ain't trying to get. The nigga comes through, and he showed me power in the so-called gay realms.
Mm.
And them niggas sit at the gateway. On the human level, call it what you want. Oh, it's disgusting. It's this, that, the other. Well, don't do it. Let them do. Who the fuck do you care who fucks who? It ain't got nothing to do with nothing. Spiritually, ain't nothing up there thinking about that because you're not a man or a woman. You're actually both. And the spirit, on the spirit level, you're androgynous. Down here, that's just hermaphrodite and something else. But on the spirit level, you actually go beyond feminine and masculine as an individual. You understand? So they show me, they say that gate, and they do it down here. You go to the club, there's a faggot right by the door. You come in, you go home, you change your shirt. Like, and so he started telling me that these motherfuckers was opening up so many gateways at Studio 54. Because for the first time, mad faggots was partying with regular people and stars. They said the motherfuckers used to be in there with fairy wings. They said, they sit over the fairy gateway. You know what I'm saying? And believe me, I got that confirmation after this shit. Mad motherfucker. If y'all want to know who some bad motherfuckers to get with, I ain't going to lie. I'm going to be absolutely real. The motherfuckers who were here and was faggots and our spirits. Sylvester, one of the baddest motherfuckers that I've channeled. He was just a gay man who did, and actually he has an unsung right now on TV One. He was a gay man who made some. He was one of the queens of disco or kings of disco. He took pictures, album pictures, in Camite gear, dressed up like Cleopatra, way before any of you niggas knew what Egyptian shit was.
Mm.
He died of AIDS, and there was a group, any New York niggas know, any OG niggas know, called Ten City. The dude from Ten City made a lot of house songs, but he sounded like Sylvester with that high pitched voice. And he made some badass house on. Sylvester told me, yeah, that was him who came back and brought back house music because they wasn't done with disco. Leroy from Fame came through. A bad faggot. This girl said her brother was sick. Her brother was gay.
Leroy the Fame on Fame is gay?
Oh, that's old school, nigga. This nigga used to run around New York looking at niggas' crotches. You know what I'm saying? Them goddamn tight ass Leroy pants. Oh, Leroy was a homo. He wasn't just a homo, nigga. He was a homo. You know what I'm saying? I said, well, I'll try to channel what entity we could use to help your brother. She was conscious. She had a gay brother who was sick. I said, and motherfucking Leroy came through. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to live forever. There was another faggot that came through when he died. He came through the same weekend that Bernie Mac died. Because that weekend was a powerful week. It was like 7707 or 8808, whatever year Bernie Mac died. When Bernie Mac died, there was two stars that were now visible. One was visible when the Moors ruled. And the other was visible, I can't remember, but it was something like when black people did whatever. But hadn't happened for like centuries, these two stars. And then Bernie Mac and Isaac Hayes died, Moses and Bernie Mac. So we tried to figure out the Bernie Mac power, so we channeled Richard Pryor. Richard Pryor came through hard. He came through talking about some faggot shit again. And he started talking about, he said, y'all need to read this shit. And then he led us in his book. I didn't know this. Richard Pryor wrote in his book that he was a faggot for a week. Did you hear about this shit?
I heard about it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yo, that shit was so. Yo, we could not stop laughing.
Yeah, tried it out, but it's found out he didn't like it.
Yeah, he tried this the way he wrote this shit. He's like, it was this bad nigga. He said, this motherfucker was bad. He said, fuck it, I'm going to be a faggot for a week. He said, he was fucking this nigga for a week.
Right.
I was like, I don't think I want to be gay anymore.
Right.
I said, yo, that shit alone just sounds so insane. So we laughing, and And he's telling me, no, you know, they explained, not Bernie Mac is just one of the old ancient motherfuckers. He said, because that's a priesthood, these comedians. And he said, he's one of the ancient motherfuckers, come home, blah, 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 blah. And know who else came through? Goddamn Miss Jerry from Martin, that old lady he used to fight.
Mm-hmm.
That bitch is an OG, too. Please believe. Miss Jerry, Miss Jerry is a bad motherfucker. Y'all niggas need to do libations to Miss Jerry. She's a bad motherfucker. She came through that weekend. And then there's another faggot that came through called Willie Ninja. Now, Willie Ninja was also in Paris is Burning. Willie Ninja didn't die. Willie Ninja, he's the one who taught Madonna how to Vogue.
Hmm.
And he used to do Vogue school. So now, going back to watching that original Paris Burning that night when my cousin came through, my cousin said they killed all of us. AIDS doesn't exist, which we knew, but he confirmed it. He said they killed all of us. I said, why did they kill all of y'all? Now, in the movie Paris is Burning, the documentary, you had these old faggots in there, and they used to do what they call these pageants. And they would dress up like Vegas showgirls. Old guy. The next level in the 70s, they would dress up like movie stars, Marilyn Monroe, and they would have these competitions and pageants. Then in the 80s, around my cousin era, they have a name for it. They still call them pageants, I believe, but what they would do is all of these faggots would create their own fashions. They would sew their own shit, and then instead of dressing up like supermodels, they would do these mock fashion shows, but the shits, because they were faggots, was insane and off the fucking hook.
Mm.
And this is where Vogue was invented. So, because they was fighting like niggas. This shit was crazy. They was fighting worse than niggas. And instead of fighting, which is divine, because that's what rap was, instead of gang wars, we started breakdancing, up-rocking, and battling each other with rap. So, because we are not by nature a violent people. So even though we were thrust into a violent situation, what we did to change it around was take that violence, added creativity, and used to battle with rap, blah, blah, blah. Now, once I seen them do that, I knew it was a separate entity, and I know this shit had to have some divinity in it because they were doing everything they were doing. We just like you don't know about gay people, so you don't know they had a whole civilization almost going on here. And Vogue, they used to fight each other, but then they changed it into Vogue battle and used to do these pageants. So my cousin started telling me he was making leather suits, suede fronts, all that shit in the 80s for niggas in the hood, jackets, coats. And she said Gloria Vanderbilt, Calvin Klein, all the names of that time used to call the crib trying to get him to get down, him and all these other faggots. But all these other faggots said, why the fuck will we work for you? We're going to do it ourselves. He said, they, at that time, would have changed the entire, rap music wasn't really out hard kicking and dominating yet. See, when rap came and dominated, that's when fashion for blacks, Rockaway and all that shit started to dominate.
Mm-hmm.
But prior to that, if it was just been black people coming out of nowhere and taking over fashion, that would have been an unprecedented worldwide event in this day. And would have changed the whole curriculum without a method that brought us there. See, we could say rap brought us here now. But see, just black people just showing up taking over fashion would have fucked every. That means, wait a minute, maybe I could take over the movies, and maybe I could take over these books, and maybe I could take over falafel stands, and maybe I could take over McDonald's. Mm-hmm. You would have had the encouragement to take over anything if you would have just seen these motherfuckers come out of nowhere and did it. The only remnant that came out of the homo world was Carl Kanai, because Carl Kanai was from that world. In fact, Carl Kanai was in the movie as a young kid, Paris is Burning. Carl Kanai never said he was gay, but he worked for Cross Colors, which was one of the first clothing companies coming up, and he came up with Kanai, and which he was gay. Mm. But he was from that world that was supposed to turn, but all these motherfuckers got killed with AIDS. So he got AIDS, all his friends got AIDS, all these people got AIDS. He said they killed us because we would not join with them. They shut
wipe
us down.
Them out.
Wipe them out.
Them out.
So, would you know they gods if they did that? So me taking my personal bias out of it, saying, no, they're just faggots, they're gay, they suck dick, that's disgusting, the black woman in the family. This ain't got nothing to do with that thought process. You got to look for the spiritual aspect. Are you occult enough, metaphysical enough, grown up enough to look at the spiritual aspect of these situations and not your personal feelings on these things? You know what I'm saying? Now, the spiritual aspect, you hear that they're attacking and dealing with these people on the same level they would anything you would call spiritual, which means you have to recognize that. You have to recognize that. And I recognize, and what it made me see was, if we're going to sit around and go, is being gay wrong or being gay a crime, a spiritual crime, and you doing all of that? Maybe on earth it is, but I can tell you where we're going after it is definitely not. I've seen far too much that says otherwise, and I've never seen nothing to the consequent shares the consequence otherwise. The only thing I've seen is spirits that made the transition who was gay, who were hiding that they were gay because of all the embarrassment on earth. They hold on to that in the spirit world. If you need a particular example, Rerun came through. And Rerun came through and said he was gay on earth. Mm. But it was because he was a young star, he didn't know how to come out. And this really disturbed him even in his death. I had to explain to him, nobody gives a shit about that. Your mastery is from many different things, and you are beyond that and all of this type of things. Like, he thanked me, and I used to go to meditation and see him doing that fucking dance. We're like, yeah, motherfucker, that's some masterful shit there. Then another sister got a channel where Rerun came to her, and she didn't even know I had this channel. And she was saying, oh, this nigga had a red dress on, saying this is really him. I said, oh, yeah, then he's freeing himself. So that's the only thing I've seen to the contrary. So these niggas got their own power. So they killed all of these homos. That must mean something because it would have turned the world around. And after that, and Willie Ninja, who didn't die till later, they didn't kill him because he would play ball. He would show white people how to vogue, eventually showing Madonna and them how to vogue. You also seen this in your lifetime in a movie called Wild Style for you OGs. You can see it now if you can get it. Wild Style was the first rap in 1981 that really documents, it's a terrible movie as a movie, but it really documents the origin of rap music in the Bronx and in Harlem. And in it, the theme of the story is Fab Five Freddy, who eventually got rewarded with MTV Raps because he was not a big deal in the game. But he did manage to get in this movie, and throughout the movie, the entire theme of the movie, he's trying to show white people the origin of rap because he's trying to get into this white world. So pretty much basically he's taking our secret music, our mystery system, and trying to present it to white people throughout this movie. And you got to understand, movies like Wild Style, Rise, and all of those type of movies are actually surveillance movies. Even that Paris is Burning is actually surveillance movies. These documentaries to look in on black folks to see exactly what the fuck we're doing, so they can see if they can cultivate a new art form to stimulate the economy. Let's look at rap. You had this thing created by us, black folks, for black folks, and done a certain way. When you have this movie Wild Style, even before Run, this is a movie before Run DMC. This is a movie, if not at the same time, a little bit even before The Message, which was a big breakthrough record because of its message, and this is when rap music was considered something that may disappear when this movie came out, and it's now a cultural icon. They reenact this movie in Europe just the way they do Rocky Horror Picture Shows, where they show it once a year and everyone dresses up. They do that in Europe for Wild Style now. It's a cultural movie now, but at the time, but for niggas, we knew, when I went to the movie, I seen it on 40 Deuce when 40 Deuce was 40 Deuce, and I had to stand up in the movie theater to watch it. And when I got home, I got a fucking ticket on the train. Real New York shit, nigga. You ain't going to get that. You ain't going to take that out of my equation. Real New York shit. The cops stopped me after going to see this movie because there was just too many niggas on the Deuce that night to see Wild Style. Now, it's a surveillance movie because soon after, Fab Five Freddy got MTV Raps, and anybody in rap knew he wasn't not necessarily not worthy, but it was one of them things. Well, why the fuck would he get it? There's so many other people who are more worthy, because it was a reward. Because the whole entire theme in that movie was to give our secret mystery system to white folks. Blondie, and that's around the time when Blondie made that song Fab Five Freddy Knows Everybody's Style. With talking about Flash is fast, Flash is cool. This was around the Wild Style era where Charlie Ahorn and the niggas was up in our shit giving us surveillance. Now, with that being said, Rise, about Crumping, they was going to see if Crumping was going to take it to the next level, because what happened after Wild Style, Wild Style was technically a graffiti movie that highlighted breakdancing and featured rap music. So graffiti was everyone in that movie and more, all the graffiti artists in New York, they immediately went to Europe, and they started putting graffiti in galleries. Graffiti was a big thing. And even those artists who are in Wild Style today are considered master graffiti artists. You got to watch a movie called Style Wars, which is also on that's on Netflix, Style Wars. And they'll show you the graffiti artists, where it started in the Bronx. They'll show you Writer's Train. And all of the original, and these motherfuckers are making their money doing murals, and they're still considered Lee. In fact, Lee was so respected from Wild Style, when I worked at the record company, I hired all his lazy-ass nephews to work. All they did was, they didn't put away no fucking CDs. They didn't do any of the mailroom shit they were supposed to do, which I hired them for. All they did was breakdance. And I let them because they was fucking Lee's nephew from Wild Style. That's how real that shit was. And he's a master artist. They commission their work like any other artist now, based upon after Wild Style going to the galleries. So after that died out, the second thing that was to come out and become the phenomenon was breakdancing. Because at that particular time, breakdancing and graffiti, rap music was only using, we didn't have our own music form, so we didn't have original music or musicians that took us serious, so everything, they didn't know how to go forth with it. So breakdancing was the only other original thing. So breakdancing went to Europe, and now you had all these breakdancing crews, Rocksteady being the hardest, because actually Beat Street came out, and the terrible movies on the West Coast, everybody outside of New York, y'all do some half-ass jobs. I ain't gonna lie. They did them Breaking 1 and Breaking 2 with that fucking white girl. What was her name? Fucking Judy or some shit. We need to save the center and Turbo and Ozone. That shit was a bunch of fucking crap. They featured rap in that shit with Ice-T. You know, come on, everybody, let's all get down to the funky sounds. Corny shit. But we love breakdancing. Niggas like fucking Ozone, the little fucking broom dance and all that corny ass shit. But Beat Street was the real shit. Niggas was on it. So now breakdancing became big and took over. It was a slow formation for rap to take over. They didn't have no path. Rap still was blowing up in New York. Everyone who from New York who would go to all down south to colleges would take the music from New York down there. College radio would embrace us. If it was popular enough, it eventually got in what they call daytime rotation. Midwest wasn't fucking with us. When Scarface in Texas, if you listen to them, they were dressed up like Run DMC, their first album. Their second album, they was following New York. It wasn't their flavor. West Coast, if you listen to NWA, them niggas had on gold ropes, big clocks. They were trying to be like us. And until eventually MTV Raps came out, Fab Five Freddy. And when they did that, everyone now in the Midwest, a lot of white people, were able to listen to rap safely in their homes without getting near it, and that's the change of it. I don't know how we got on this subject, but we are there. So all of this stuff, now, as I pointed out, these things were surveillance video when they do these documentaries. So was Wild Style a surveillance video? Rap music has now been a multi-billion-dollar business that has changed the face of this world, not for us, for them. It may have generated some millionaires for us, but it's a multi-billion-dollar industry for them. So surveillance going well. All right. Another good book, Voodoo in Haiti by Alfred Mitrux. More voodoo stuff, more ritual, more backstory on hoodoo, voodoo in Haiti. I believe this is the one where he talks about what you call the Petros. The Loas, he talks about dreams, Kola twins, animal release, possession, voodoo pantheon, power of the Loa, flag parade, ritual situations, voodoo cult groups, music, dance, conjure the Loa, Feast of Yam, Voodoo Christmas in Haiti, divination, white magic, secret sorcerers, magic and sorcery. Yeah, he just goes into a lot of the history and what it's about. But since I did bring up what they call the Petros, let me tell you the difference. In Ifa is the Nigerian Yoruba people's religion. Ifa is the name of the religion. The name of the deities collectively are called the Orishas. So Oshun, Ogun, Legba, Obatala, Shango, Ochosi, Oya, Yiminya, I'm sure I'm missing a couple more, are actually collectively called the Orishas or the Orishas. Mm-hmm. Now, in voodoo, the collective deities are Zuli, Papa Gede, Don Balawedo, Edowedo, and I'm sure I'm missing, I'm missing so many. I mean, when I get to it, I'll give you voodoo books that will be to die for. One I don't see, where is that book at? Well, nobody robbed me for it. It might be upstairs with Khadija. Sally N. I'll just say it's Sally, I think, N. Glassman, but Sally Glassman, her voodoo book, what is it called? Haitian voodoo. She goes through every lower, every idea and how it's been deified. Like, she even has a deity for a goddamn carnival and how to raise it up. Sally Ann Glassman, can't remember the name of the book. I think Khadija was reading it. It's upstairs. If not, we're going to find it and get to it. Anyway, the collective pantheon of deities are called Loa in Haiti. Like, they're called the Orishas, they're called the Loa. So you hear somebody say the Loas. Now, there's a guy who, that's why you need to understand when somebody is talking about tradition and it must be done that way, it must be done this way, it's bullshit. Not because of all the minutes of information and I've been given to you on detail. Let's just say for this reason alone, something they call the Petro spirits. In Haiti, after they were dealing with the Loa, and the Loa are actually a collective bunch of deities from African, multi-African cultures. So it's not like we were dealing with a voodoo in Africa and brought it to Haiti. It was because all of these slaves were being gathered around from different cultures. When we collectively got together in all these different cultures, everybody put their 2 cents in, and that 2 cents became ancestor worship or the Loas. So even voodoo, which people try to say you need to keep it real with the initiation of voodoo, is something that was collectively put together as an amalgamation. But now I'll give you something even more, which is called the Petros. There's a guy, such and such Petro is his name, who said we need to custom tailor fit this Haitian religion that we're dealing with, or spiritual system actually that we're dealing with, for the war that's going on. And what the white man is using against us is gunpowder. So he created from the Loas what they call Petro spirits. Some are new, and some are updated versions of the Loas. And this particular pantheon is much darker the way you deal with them, and most of the rituals, he incorporates gunpowder into the rituals and how you feed them, because the gunpowder was the actual tool that was being used against us in the war. So now, lo and behold, years later, the Petro spirits are a pantheon that's respected, well-known, out there they call the Petros.
Mm-hmm.
So you have, so if someone is talking about keeping it real and do that by initiation, that small example goes to show you, motherfuckers, you adjust your spiritual system to what's happening physically. That's why you make a spiritual system. So you cannot deal with an African initiation in America because you are not dealing with the same issues in Africa that you're dealing with here, asshole. You have to upgrade, at the very least, create an initiation system, which you do not need. But let's say you feel you need this, and if someone feels they need it, you at very least deal with an initiation system that means something to Americans, to you or to you in America, because you're not African, you don't know shit about Africa, you would die in a week if they put your ass in Africa. You would die in a week not from what's over there, but from what's not over there, like a fucking light bulb. And, nigga, ain't no light bulb. Oh, shit, nigga. And by the time they tell you ain't no fucking ring-dings, ain't no fucking devil dogs and Twinkies, you can't get no M&Ms, then you, nigga, you will pass the fuck out. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Ain't no Snickers. Oh, God. Ain't no Snapple. You got to go get your water from the creek. You know what I'm saying? Y'all ain't got no Poland Springs or no alkali. No, nigga, go stick your head in the creek. Don't drink the flies, though, nigga. Get that fucking malaria on that ass. Spirits of the Night, The Voodoo Gods of Haiti by Selden Rodman and Carol Cleaver. More ritual, more voodoo information. This was a real good to the point book. And they actually go through some of the, myths, fables, or bullshit. And they, you know, they put that back in truth in that book. The Book of Lilith, Barbara Black Coltiv, K-O-L-T-U-V, Barbara Black, K-O-L-T-U-V, Ph.D., The Book of Lilith, excellent book about the deity Lilith, probably one of the most powerful books on the feminine energy, and she doesn't go into detail. I have books on the detail, but Lilith is also known as your menstruation. So if you read the Book of Lilith or understand the deity Lilith, Lilith is the spiritual aspect of your menstruation. She is known as the baby killer. So if you have your menstruation, you're not having a baby. And not just for that, she's the god of blood. You may have seen more of her on last or the season before, one of them, either last season or I know it was the season before last of True Blood. They dealt with Lilith as the vampire god.
Mm-hmm.
And Lilith, you can find, maybe in the Talmud, which is the older books, the books of Moses, where before Eve, they tried to marry Adam to Lilith, but she was way too powerful, so they had to revamp Eve, or send him Eve in the mythology and send Lilith back to the heavens. So anything you read, Lilith is a good deity to have for power, clearing shit out, needing, and she goes into detail, practical uses, the mythology. I mean, you'll get a lot out of this book. And she may even do some correspondences with Lilith, this one, that one, and another pantheon. This is a pretty good book, Golden Secrets of Mystic Oils by Anna Riva. Anna Riva, she's done a few other books, which we'll talk about. In she just talks about oil, Holy Trinity oil, Holy Death oil, how to use it, Helping Hand oil, and Heart's Desire oil. So now when I heard all these oils, I'm like, where the fuck do you get it and how you made it? Botanicas. This is one of the books that you'll find in Botanicas. Another good book is Love, Charms, and Spells by Jade. Anything you want to deal with love, charms, and spells is in this book. Rituals, a lot of Botanica items. So you get a few items, and she tells you how to maintain a lover. But ultimately, you should not use that to keep a lover, because then you're only going to create a ghoul. If in the person's past to leave you, real dark magic or real evil magic is actually that, actually keeping someone with you against their will. So the idea of light and dark magic has nothing to do with, okay, it's Baphomet is dark, so it's evil, or it's Obatala is light, so it's good. That's ridiculous. Because if you use, let's just say, Obatala to keep a motherfucker thinking about you all day, that's evil. When in his will, he doesn't want to think about your monkey ass all day. So if you do a ritual to even use your energy with the aid of Obatala's energy to help him think about you, that's what's actually evil and magic. So you trying to get someone to love you against your will, their will actually, is actually true evil. So any love charm you do is to make yourself more irresistible to attract someone faster that would have been attracted to you anyway, or to reinforce a love that you already have, or to find a soulmate who may be a generic. So you could do love spells to find to find your soulmate, but this is a soulmate that was destined for you anyway. So somebody who's tired of your monkey ass and you still fucking love the dick or the pussy too good for you to stop and you doing rituals, you the evil one. Let that shit go. The Complete Book of Voodoo, Robert W. Pelton, yet another voodoo book. You can see I didn't realize there were so many voodoo books. But he goes through information, just more general voodoo information. This is a good book. I think you'll still be able to get it. Somebody was asking me about this last week. Paulo Mayombe, Spirit, Rituals, and Spell, 20th Anniversary Edition. This is not the same out-of-print Paulo Mayombe book that I sell. This one is by the same author, Carlos Antonio de Bourbon Galdo Montenegro. His name got much, much longer now. And I believe it's because Bobby, especially, but me as well, have did a lot to make his book very popular. Carlos Montenegro is an occultist who put out a book called Paulo Mayombe. This was different because most of the Paulo books, which came out of Cuba, because that's where it's originally from, the Congo, Africa. But Paulo's a darker form. It's really not a darker form, but it's darker when you compare it to Ifa that everyone has held their fell in love with. And prior now, and I'll point out something else. There's another book called The Book of Paulo with Baba Raul Carnazares. Made the transition and we made contact with him. In it, he talks about four different branches of Paulo. Now, what we're talking about now, Paulo Mayombe is the darkest form of Paulo. Paulo Monte is actually what they call the lighter form of Paulo. In that book that Carlos Baba Raul Carnazares, he talks about Paulo Monte. And in it, what he does is take the Paulo deities and make a connection with the Orishas. Now, once he did that, he made it very safe to even deal and talk about Paulo. I remember before that book came out, if you said to anyone dealing with Ifa or the Orishas, anything Paulo, it was like conjuring up the devil itself. They had no idea what it was. It was just some dark force shit. Once he made that book and added to the Orishas and the faces that you know and love, everyone became Paleros and interested in Paulo, and Paulo information became all available. That's a different thing. That's Paulo Monte. Paulo Mayombe is the so-called darker when you pair it to Ifa, and most of that stuff was done in Cuba. The ritual's a little bit more crass compared to Ifa or Santeria. And most of the information on it is in Spanish, therefore not picked up. The first book I've seen, and I think out, that was in English, is the one that's out of print, Paulo Mayombe by Carlos Montenegro, which he kept 11 deities, gave their signatures, Paulo sticks, what it means, certain rituals, and that these deities were used in his family for quite some time. It was done in English. And the entire magical religious community has took the greatest shit in the world. When I was dealing with this and putting this information up on MySpace, you had plenty of folks coming up to me You're not a real Polaro. You fucking right I'm not, because that's a slave, motherfucker. I'm a master. I dabble in it all,
right.
Motherfucker.
Right.
Be gone, bitch. You the fuck. You can call yourself whatever you want. Then after they got that point, they started to go hard at Carlos Montenegro. Even his book on Amazon, they shit on. This isn't real. You will die. You know, Paddock, I had to take 10 of his people and do this and do that and do the other thing and clean them for years, and he fucked them up. I'm like, what does that got to do with the price of anything? You know what I'm saying? Because it's still that same religious mentality. It's almost like if I'm saying Christianity, I'm also saying, well, I believe in T.D. Jakes and I believe in Creflo Dollar. So if Creflo Dollar and T.D. Jakes do something wrong, Christianity is wrong. You know what I'm saying? Now, Christianity is wrong for a different reason, but you know the average Christian looks at their preacher as a representation, and one hand, the religious mindset is one hand washes the other. When technically it has nothing to do with each other. They're fucked up for different reasons. You get what I'm saying? But the average Christian looks at them as synchronicity. So when these niggas are saying Carlos Montenegro is this, therefore I'm never going to read his book because his book may be channeled through him. Fuck him. And as a cultist, that's what it's supposed to be. Same way I tell you every day, if me and you personally don't get along, don't let that, don't cut off your nose to spite your face. I know what I bring is a message from the spirit world that has changed lives. And I know it will change yours. And if it don't, that just only means you have graduated past it. Goody for you. But if you don't like the way I said to you, your dress don't fit right, or your hair is nappy, or you don't like that I put this picture up, don't let that stop you from getting a message. That means you have a religious mindset. So if you don't like the way Creflo Dollar asks for your, if you're a Christian and you don't like the way Creflo Dollar is doing things, will it inhibit your Christianity or so on and so forth? So now, the book I do know. So after me and Bobby went Paulo Muyombe, especially Bobby, you know that was Bobby's thing. When Paulo Muyombe, it got embraced by more people and more people. Started to, because I know this to be a fact, because the people that I've introduced to Paulo Muyombe have told me they went and found Carlos Montenegro to ask him questions and have said the name to him, Panic and Bobby, and this is where we're getting that and this and that and again. So what we started to notice, this nigga became a cult icon again, and he has a following. He started up groups again, and motherfuckers is following him, and so on and so forth. So he released another book called Paulo Muyombe, Spirits and Rituals. In fact, it's so me and Bobby got actually the sister Denise out of New York. I'm going to shout her out. She actually sent me and Bobby, she bought this book for me and Bobby, because you can only be in his group or get it from his website or be plugged in to get this book, I believe. I think he's selling it now at the time. And so we thought we was getting maybe a little bit more of the original Paulo, but it's actually a different book with much more information. And this is Paulo Muyombe, Spirits and Ritual Spells, 20th Anniversary Edition. And so it was actually a different book, which he rehashed because we made the original book so popular. You get what I'm saying? It's like a book I still sell now because it's out of print and it's really good. And that's Paulo Muyombe, Carlos Montenegro. So if you could get your hands on any of those, excellent. The other book, like I said, if you can't get it, you want it, come see me. And the other book is too big. I don't copy it. The 20th edition, but you may be able to get that. And we also noticed out of his popularity, some of his books now he has turned from Spanish to English because now he has an English following based upon Bobby Hemming and myself. One of them is called Mayombero, M-A-Y-O-M. B-E-R-O. I got this at a Botanica, so which means you may be able to get it on Amazon, and it's called Black Magic Rituals, Carlos Antonio Montenegro. He deals with the spirits of Lucero. He goes into a different set of Paulos, more past the 11 that he gave out in his original Paulo Muyombe book. He goes into still has them here, Mama Shola Sete Leos, Zarabanda, but he goes into Lucero, which is like an Alegba figure, Timbla, Tira, Madre de Agua, which is one of his old ones, Cabo Rondo. He goes into there, he gives out ritual spells, Ibus, combination. And usually his shit is really light in terms of the rituals that you can get into with him, the items that he needs. He does a lot, you know, a chicken, you know, you ain't got to go that far. We've channeled over and over that the spirits don't really need that or want that. Understand this, the original sacrifice was period blood and sperm, but as sex and period blood became demonized, it eventually went to animals. So if you feel you need to sacrifice, period blood or sperm will do the trick, or any sexual fluids. And if you feel you're good enough to cut up some chickens, knock yourself out. Don't let that stop you. But your spirit will tell you what to substitute if it's too much. So you can substitute these things. You judge a ritual on if it works, not if you're doing it right. If it works, do whatever. And at the end of the day, if it doesn't work, try it a different way or try a different thing. Another good book, How to Use an Ouija Board, Communications with the Spirit World by Michael St. Christopher. It's a little handbook. If you can get that book, because it will, many people ask me how to use it and should you use it? Absolutely. The Ouija board is a Moorish invention. It is ours. The difference is because it became a game, what people started doing was just getting on their Ouija board and letting it go wherever it went to go. The difference is you use it as a divination tool, which means you don't go wherever it goes. You go in there with a purpose to channel. So you go in there to channel Hanuman, or you go in there to channel whatever deity. This way, nothing just shows up out the blue. Okay, an excellent book. You can get it at Botanica's. You probably can get it online. The World's Greatest Magician, Black Herman. The Magic, the Secrets, Magic, Mystery, and Legermain. The Missing Keys to Success, Health, and Happiness. Black Herman. If you niggas do not know who Black Herman is, go ahead home and choke yourself. Go ahead and choke yourself. I don't know if Aline Bay is there, but Aline put up an announcement. March 21st, 22nd, 23rd of 2014, we will teach various African rituals, herbalism, Mantu arts, Chai Kung, Tai Chi, Usi, Reiki, Tibetan Sekum, 1, 2, 3, and etc. Call 910-364-9099. Or go to the website, DrAlineLBay.com, to calendar events. So y'all heard that announcement, and get on it. When I tell you, I don't know anybody here who does not have this understanding or maybe kidding yourself as Aline not being a master teacher, but if you think that's the case, you done fucked up. Aline can teach these things, and not only teach them well. So if you're interested in any of these things, or I suggest you find an interest in these things, because you will see how they will change your life. DrAlineLBay.com or call 910-364-9099. And this is happening March 21st, 22nd, 23rd of 2004. So now is the time to get on this. All right? So Black Herman, if you don't know who he is, choke yourself. The template of Houdini and all of these Chris Angels and that other clown that used to just sit in a box, David Blaine and all of these guys, they get it from a black man from Harlem called Black Herman. And in this book, this tells Black Herman's story, and this motherfucker was badass. They would arrest his ass, and by the time they put him in jail downtown, go back up to Harlem, this nigga would be sitting up there playing dominoes. You know what I'm saying? He went to Egypt to the mystery system, got mysteries. He was the master escape artist, the master magician, and the shit he puts down here is absolutely off the hook. They give his rendition on the mysteries of astrology and certain rituals and things you can do, all from perspective of Black Herman, a black man from Harlem, that all that Houdini, Chris Angel bullshit that we watching now comes from. Voodoo Shaman, The Haitian Way of Healing and Power by Ross Haven. Excellent book, healing power, rituals, information on the voodoo perspective. I think I gave out this book. If not, because I know I have two of them, so they may come out twice. Creating Magical Entities, Complete Guide to Entity Creation by David Michael Cunningham. I think I gave that out, but not only there's about 10 different entities types that he talks about and how to create them, entities for the long term and the short term, and so on and so forth. This is an interesting reference book. You won't probably use this much or read through it much, but you can use it because you'll see it come up sometime in magic, and if you're this type of person, you'll definitely use it. I'm not this type of person in rituals. A lot of rituals, they tell you to recite prayers and chants from certain books. Usually I make my own or don't do it, but one of those books you'll find all the time that they reference is the 6 and 7 books of Moses. And the name of this is the 6 and 7 books of Moses and the magical uses of palms, or psalms, actually. So psalms is actually a magic book that are hymns of Tehuti, and they later become psalms. So a lot of these psalms will come up in rituals. See, sing Psalm 7, Psalm 11, Psalm this, Psalm that. And that's because they do have magical uses in the conjuration. And I'm sure Aleem, if haven't talked about it, and I'm sure he's brought it up before, because Aleem understands a PhD. He has a PhD in this. So that Dr. Aleem is not just a title that he just decided to throw on his name. And I think it's in theology, if I'm not mistaken. So he knows this shit, and because he is conscious in our in our circle, he understands it on a level that I've never seen anyone break down the Bible.
Oh yeah,
even within our circle. And with that being said, I'm sure he's talked about, and I'm sure I'm not remembering, the power of psalms, the origin, and decoded what these incantations in psalms mean. So I know you know it's from the Bible, but don't throw that away just because it's in the Bible. It has a metaphysical origin, as the entire Bible does, but people are still, you'll see that in these books, because you still can use those psalms or songs of Solomon for magic, magical uses. And the 6 or 7 book of Moses, there's a lot of tablets that they show and what the tablets mean and what they can use for. And so I have it as a reference book to have that in the house, because you'll come across magic that will refer to that. Okay, another excellent book, one of the ones Bobby recommends the most, and out of all the voodoo books that we talked about, is The Secrets of Voodoo by Milo Rigaud. Last name spelled R-I-G-A-U-D, first name M-I-L-O. In it, he gives a lot of veves. Veves are the signatures of the Loa. And these signatures are important because the signatures communicate with the subconscious mind, and this is the realm you're trying to access in the first place when you deal with deities. So when you could bypass the conscious understanding of Oshun and start dealing with the symbolic nature of Oshun, you're actually starting to get closer to the spirit. So the Veve is actually something that's their actual antenna signature, or their spiritual signature that gets closer to the spirit, because it's a direct communication with the subconscious. And in all of the voodoo books, you will come across how they're used, the items that you use to create them, and some of those books also have veves as well. Milo Rigaud has a big, complete set of them. And he also gives a whole laundry list of all the African cultures that voodoo is derived from. So when I get that information about voodoo is an amalgamation of many African cultures, which some asshole probably was saying, this is not the real thing because no one initiated into back then. That fucking dick who was saying that back then is just a rehashing, rebirth, a goddamn rendition of the same dick today, trying to convince you to initiate something. Because at the end of the day, once you say, well, you know something, I'm convinced I need to initiate, they get to tell you, well, now you need to give me $5,000, faggot. And then at the end of the day, you find out it's all about how much money they could get out your ass for something that you need absolutely nothing of.
Mm-hmm.
Esotericism and Symbol by R.A. Swalodlubicz. Excellent fucking book. This is the book that we actually did our lecture here on First World Order Radio about the difference between esoteric and exoteric thought. A must-hear lecture. One of the ones I think was done very well in a classic. A lot of that information that I used as examples was out of the book esotericism of symbol by R.A. Swallow DeLubis. R.A. Swallow DeLubis is one of those scholars who said that black folk is black folk. I mean, Egyptian shit is black folk shit. Scholarly suicide. His daughter is married to Anthony West, who y'all might know of, because he's still around. He may even be on Facebook. He's definitely on YouTube. And that's why he smiles kind of nicely on black folks. Him, like Lon Milo Duquette, they work together because his father-in-law, Davina's coming in and laughing at my glasses again. All right, I just see how you're doing. His father-in-law is a Swallow DeLubis. And Swallow DeLubis is best credit. You going to sleep? How you feel, better? All right. I'll see you in a little bit, sweetie. All right. His father-in-law is most known, Swallow DeLubis is most known for decoding the Temple of Man, Temple of Luxor. What he found out when he went through this gigantic temple that is actually shaped like the body of man. And the initiate would start at the feet in this temple and eventually work their way up to the top three chambers. And in these three top chambers is where they would actually mix the lotus flower with other solutions to tap into the DMT. And you would walk out that temple on the shamanistic level. At a certain time, you go through this ritual, then you would actually go to a different place or come from a different place and go back to your culture, the shaman, to give them spiritual advice. So you would actually walk throughout this whole temple. In it, what makes this temple famous is they have a gigantic hieroglyph of sperm. And, of course, this is baffling the white people because this is supposedly before there was a microscope to confirm that. So they're like, how did the Egyptians know? Well, we knew how to go into self. There could be 1,000 explanations of how we knew, but we know we knew. You know what I'm saying? I.e., it's written in stone. So Swallow DeLubis is that dude. Anything he writes is a must-have, along with another writer, Gerald Massey, who I talked about. He was the one who said this black shit, this Egyptian shit is nigger shit. To the point where it was scholarly suicide for him. He has a version of the Egyptian Book of the Dead, the Ancient Mystery Systems of Amenta, the Book of Going Forth by Day by General Masti.
Right.
Masti. One of his most famous books is Ancient Egypt, Light of the World. Expensive shit. If you can get that at a good price, it's a must-have. But I didn't know who General Masti was. They eventually resurfaced his lectures at a bookstore. So I remember hearing Bobby say at that time, Gerald Massey. So I called Bobby and said, Bobby, they have some Gerald Massey's lectures. Should I get that? He said, do not walk, run, and get that shit. He said, you should not walk out that place without anything from Gerald Massey. And, of course, I got him. And I told you about that book earlier.
Yeah, he's right.
Another
he's
book. Right, yes, he's right. Another book by Mogente Gonzalez Whipler. Power of the Orishas, Santeria, and the Workshop of the Saint. Excellent book if anybody who's never heard of this Orisha thing, because she takes every Orisha and tells you about the saint that is connected to them and how they connected, when they were connected, all the details. And she goes into deep information about a particular saint. Now, let's take, for example, Orunala. Which is the divination nigga, which is a nigga who came to me, had to give up his power when I was channeled. So I didn't have to ask him for shit. The nigga was mad because my rise in consciousness, he can't hold on to that no more. It was basically like we're becoming them and they have to move on and transfer. And I've told this before. The Orishas have transformed. If you're calling on the Orishas now, you're calling on echoes. Believe that. They're calling on echoes. Their energy has moved the fuck on. And a lot of that has happened. I've witnessed it happen. And this is because these energies are nothing but part of your own psyche. So as our consciousness rise, it does impact these energies that were on our level. They were created on our level before. They were created on our level. If we go to another level, then these energies are sitting there going, I can't serve you because you are no longer on that level. I can only serve stuck motherfuckers. So you stuck motherfuckers are still fucking with stuck-ass deities. Y'all niggas don't even get common sense logic to this. You're so fucking religified. You stuck on this shit. You know what I'm saying? So those energies have moved the fuck on. They got new names and everything. Them motherfuckers came to me with hate, like, how dare you come and take our shit just because, not even dealing with them, just because of our conscious rise. You're gaining more light, so you're matching their light, you silly Negroes. So they're looking at me like, who is this? Because all they can see is light. And before, you niggas just looked like dots who gave them shit. Here's water, Oshun. Get me some fucking penis. Here's water, Oshun. I would like some wet pussy. Here's water, Oshun. May I find a soft avocado this weekend that's fucking not cloned? Whatever the fuck you guys are praying and begging for. They didn't see you as individuals. I like you better than her. You're a daughter of Oshun. And you their fucking slave. You their fucking copycat slave. You know what I'm saying? That's like me saying I'm a son of a lean, and I just act like a lean. At what point did Lean go, you just didn't get off my dick? You know what I'm saying? My son is supposed to be greater than me. Is he not? Is he not? If I have a son, he ain't going to do this. I'm a janitor. I'm trying to make sure I save my janitor bucks so that nigga can at least go to law school or some kind of shit, be a veterinarian. I'm a janitor and you a janitor. I'll be like, yeah, good job. We made a fucking lateral movement, motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? Good job. So I'm a daughter of Oshun, so I copy Oshun. Don't make no sense. You're not even none of that. Oshun, like every other entity, came from your black divine mind, which means they're your fucking children in the first place. And you their bitch now? Oh, yeah. Oshun got mad at me. That's so ridiculous. That's as ridiculous as you saying you're getting shocked by electricity. Oh, the electricity was mad at me. No, motherfucker. Electricity is not mad at you. You know what I'm saying? So Oshun is nothing but electricity. I'm sorry to burst your bubble, but Oshun is nothing but electricity. And it's electricity with a personality because the personality is trying to explain to you how to access it as opposed to a different form of energy. That's how you access that. They're not your parents. They're not your father. They do not lord over you unless you say, Lord over me. Unless you say it. If you agree to that shit, by all means, guess who you are? They're a motherfucking child. If you agree to it. If you agree to initiate and be their bitch, by all means, bitch out. Don't come to me trying to debate, though. Don't come to me trying to debate because you're not even in the game with me. Mm-hmm. You debate with them. You're not even in the game with me. I'm talking to people outside of that bullshit slavery. Outside of that, you in the game with me. You can ask me a question or bring me information that may be changed or add on. Some niggas, if you wearing a fucking Oshun hat, enjoy your hat, nigga. You wearing an Obatala dress and you a grown-ass man, nigga. You know what I'm saying? Fabulous. Runway. You know what I'm saying? Wear your Obatala dress, Miss Thing. You know what I'm saying? Ain't none of that shit. You know what I'm saying? Grow up, niggas. This shit is nothing more than electricity in a wall. What you plug into your electricity gives it definition. It's a light, it's a microwave, it's an iron. That's all this shit is. An abundance of electricity in the ether. How you access it is through the ritual, colors, days, pictures, statues, attitude, mentality, dreams, fucking, sucking, drinking, eating, sacrifice, or whatever it is you're doing is the access of how you access electricity just the same way you plug shit in. And it's there. When did you become a child of your fucking microwave? When did you become a child of your goddamn iron? When did you become a child of your goddamn AM radio? That sounds ridiculous. Those are your items. And I hate to burst your bubble. Grow up. These fucking deities are your fucking items. So you don't run around here, I'm a child of fucking Shango. Yeah, do that shit. He will rape your monkey ass. I would. You tell me you a child of me, boy, oh boy. You see the fun weekend that I'm going to have planned for you. Tell me I'm a child of you. Oh, I'm glad you said that because my leaves and shit need to be raked the fuck up. Oh, I am glad you said that because I got a bunch of boxes that need to come out the basement, nigga. Oh, panic, I'm a child of you. I'm glad you said that. How tight is your vagina? My child, how tight is your vagina? I can't do that now. Wikipedia. Just theoretically, how tight is your vagina? My child. What's your head game like, my child? Panic, I'm a child of you. Really? How's your doggy style, my child? So don't think these spirits were created out of your mind. So these spirits are niggas, too. Most people who are in my class and take my class, who are now actualizing this information that they be dealing with, what they're starting to notice is things that I've been saying about how these spirits' mentalities are. They're like, shit, I'm... really see what you mean. I'm dealing with a bunch of niggas. So when I hear somebody talking that dignified shit, I'm going, that's real cool, and it sounds real smashing, debonair. It sounds real auditory and pleasing to themselves, I guess, and to those who think that it's about knowledge, but they haven't tapped into nothing spiritually. Because nothing spiritually ends like that. For two reasons. You say, well, maybe panic, nothing spiritually answered like you that because you can't talk like that. Oh, yes, I could. And I did. And got clowned for it. You get what I'm saying? Oh, my God. That which brings forth reciprocity and balance, the winged Isis of healing, who is known throughout eternity and the eternal within, without that comes as the form of balance, love, justice for all who we seek. As she said, what in the fuck are you talking about? I said, well, what you want, bitch? She said, oh, now we can get down to it, nigga. When I woke up, I said, I get it. Niggas don't talk like that. Why would anything spiritually talk like that? And nothing has. Niggas, there's gateways I had to get in where I had to play the fucking dozen talks about niggas' moms before they said, you may pass. I get to the threshold, they're like, nigga, you can't get in here. I had to talk about their moms. Your fucking mom's, you know what I'm saying? Your mom's got a 3-foot house in the underworld. Oh, this nigga, come on in, nigga. You a real nigga. They looking for real nigga shit. So if you ain't honest with yourself, you're not getting in nothing spiritually. You heard me?
Right.
If you're not honest with yourself, you're not breaking through. And most of you niggas ain't honest with yourself. Hold up and all that shit and don't even mean that shit. Oh, she's the queen and goddess. No, you hate these bitches. How do you know? Because all the women who saw that I got with this nigga, he ho-tepped me, he queened me, he goddessed me, he said fucking fruit falls out my titties, and this nigga got to my house and did that same old nigga I could have met in the club shit. I said, yeah, because he hates you. He's trying to find a better way, and now we so deep in the game, niggas know this language is pussy language for low self-esteem women who are not tapping into nothing but the outer self at this outer goddess shit. My hair is nice. You know what I'm saying? I'm wearing this. I use that. I don't eat that. I'm a goddess. No, you need to tap into these energies to make you a god or a goddess.
Yeah.
What you got on that, son? And you cannot be their fucking daughter of this and son of that and tap in. All you can be is exactly what you said, the daughter of some one streamlined fucking energy. As much appliances as I got in my house, the fucking iron is not my favorite. How about that? I like all my shit. I need my light, my iron, my pizza maker, my fucking microwave, my fucking stove, my TV, my goddamn Netflix, my goddamn cable box, all that shit that takes electricity, my computer, you know what I'm saying, my fucking Isaac Hayes dance doll. I need all that shit to be plugged the fuck in, and I love it all. Why? Because you're a multi-level nigga when you think that way, but then when you say, well, I'm Oshun. I'm a daughter of Oshun. How do you take all of these energies, and there's fucking thousands of them? Encyclopedia of Spirits by Judica Ilks, Dictionary of Ancient Deities by Patricia Turner and Charles Coltier shows you thousands upon thousands of deities that you could tap into from worldwide, and they only have the popular ones. You will never read through those books in a lifetime of all the possible energies you could be while you stuck on Shingles, my father. That is fucking utterly ridiculous. Utterly fucking ridiculous. I said it. It's utterly ridiculous. It is small-minded, it's religious, and you might as well stick with Jesus because he got more hits, nigga. He got more hits, more likes than Shango. You're not tapping into nothing special. It's your mentality towards the energies that I'm not saying Shango's not the thing to tap into. I'm saying your mentality towards Shango and Oshun, that's the issue. See, I use an iron, but my mentality towards my iron, I use it for its proper use. It does not dominate my life. So you got these niggas who are dominating, these deities who are dominating, these small deities who are dominating your life. That's different than you taking that and accessing it and using it to your fucking benefit. You can't say I'm a child of Oshun and I'm a goddess. That don't make no sense. To say you're a goddess or a god, you must deal with them on a peer level.
Right.
On a level of a peer.
Right.
Get on. That's the joint.
Mm-hmm.
So the power of the Rishis, Santeria, the workshop of the saints by Magente Gonzalez Whippler. Excellent book. She goes through them all. And I was going to go through Ochosi. But I use Babalu Aye. That's my boy, too. He's St. Lazarus. She does Babalu Aye's representation. Then she goes through his attributes, you know, numbers, days of the week, color. Babalu Aye as an archetype. Then paths of Babalu Aye, she'll tell you that there are different paths of Babalu Aye. There's a Babalu Aye of this, a Babalu. And that's another thing. I do this in my class, I go through, Oshun has like 22 paths, I think. I go through the 22 paths of Oshun. Did you know there's an Oshun of swamp waters, Oshun of sewer waters? You'll never find that Oshun on Facebook. See, you find Oshun of the pretty pussy honey pot Oshun. But there's Oshun of jealousy, Oshun. There's different, cause the same way love is complex, they have to have paths of Oshun that become just as complex. You understand? So there's different versions of Oshun. Now, anyone who's got their head done knows that. But just anyone who picks Oshun as a new nickname is picking the basic Oshun, which is not even fucking real. So they go through the paths of Babalu Aye in this book. Then they go through the initiation rites of Babalu Aye. The Olu, I think that's, I don't know. I can't remember what the African word is. It's an African word, but I think it's numbers. It's something with the numbers and dates, something on that level. A legend of him. They also call that Pataki. But it's his legend, so they give you a little mythology. The rulership of him, the Igbos. Igbos are, that's what I do remember, that's a sacrifice. So cleansing for good luck, a cleansing to regain good health, for money, they got two in there for money. That's just Babalu Aye. So they keep that same pattern going for all of the deities, the main deities and a few of the minor ones in her book. So that's an excellent book just for anybody who's trying to get out some Orisha history. And I'm going to some more books. And again, I was running my mouth. We didn't get no fucking where.
Oh, it's all right, so, boy.
Just fuck around. This might be an 8-part show the way we going. All right, I'm going to get more books and... If we get cut off, let me give everything out. Remember, my herb packs. If you ain't got my herb packs, you ain't doing shit with your life. Stop fucking around and get a fucking herb pack, you lazy bastards. It is the shit to get. It works. It opens up your pineal. All natural herbs. You email me for it, panicpack@hotmail.com. There's no reason you should be dicking around on this goddamn issue. Get you an herb pack. All natural, can't go wrong with it. It is, shit, not only is it good, shit, it's good for you, nigga. You got to get you one of these, nigga. And, like I said, If you're not a smoker, you can drink it. They're still very cheap. I sell these things for very cheap. You know what I'm saying? All you have to do is email me, panicpack@hotmail.com. I send you my catalog because not only do I sell that, I sell a shitload of magical tools. No home should be without it. And what I don't have in terms of the magic you need, what you can't find at a Botanica or it may be easier, you can get from DrAlimElBay.com. That's our beloved brother Dr. Aleem's website, a shitload of information, services, and product you can get from him. And also my classes. Now, I've spoken sweet sugar on these classes. Stop fucking bullshitting. We're about to get into another cycle. I'm finishing up a cycle now, which means we're going to start taking a new cycle soon. So now is the time to get in and pay. It's a must. This is a life-changing class, the yen. It's for beginners as well as advanced students. No matter where you are on your level of magic, you will understand and can take this class. So it's not like you have to get to a certain amount of level to take this class. It is designed masterfully by me, the curriculum, 4 weeks of class, masterly designed by me to speak and to be understandable for those starting out and still to speak to those who've been in this for 20, 25 years. There are people who have been in this that long and have taken the class and said, I thought I knew all there was to know. No, but this class has changed my whole shit. I designed it with everything that was in me for the problems that I see the most. And the problem I seen the most was a lot of people getting a lot of information, dealing with a lot of surface level, but always looking at me as I'm doing something that they cannot do. So now, first time, I give out the secrets of everything that you should do as an ABC step program from A, B, C, E to D to Z of how to tap into all the magic shit you've ever heard me do on your own, your way, at your own pace, and with your own and with a clear understanding of what you're doing, more than just an informational level, an actualization level. The class is extremely cheap for what you get. Let me say that again. Extremely cheap for what you get. And believe you me, you get this class, you will know it's coming from my heart. I go into detail, long drawn out. I answer any question that you have going on in terms of the curriculum, and it will change your life. Again, you do not have to ask me, because each time you inquire about the class, not only do I send you the information about the next cycle, how to make payment, I also break down payments. I send you a whole list of people who've taken the class who you can ask them directly, their emails. You can ask them directly, what has this done for you? And they will tell you in their own words, well, goddamn, I'm a whole new nigga. I get it all the time, but you don't even got to listen to that. You can go into the shows that you heard on New World Order, and people randomly, not because Aleem deals with the phone, so he doesn't know anybody's number or nobody. There's people who listen who randomly have called in and said, I'm calling for this, but I've also taken the class, and I asked them to speak on the class, and you should hear what they have to say. Life-changing. I was here, now I'm there. I was doing this, now I'm doing that. I did this at my whatever branch of life they applied to. My job was fucked up. Now I can't wait to go to work. Yes, sir, boss. Get it right away. You want to do this. I'm telling you, you don't want to think about this and put this off. You want to do this. The book, I got my girl Tammy finishing up the last part of that document that needed to be proofread. She reads just like me, edited, so much so that I'm adding some of the old chapters. I'm updating them. She put a new life in my ass, so the book will even be longer. The next step, and we have a few people, if anybody knows anybody, they call it formatting. Formatting. So that's basically taking the documents and putting them in book formation. I know nothing about this. If anybody, I'd rather somebody send me a program that does this. But if there's a person that does this or a company that does this, get at me, panicpack@hotmail.com, PanicPackHotmail.com, panicpack@hotmail.com. You need to get with me for classes. This is a must for anybody who takes themselves even half seriously. If you take yourself seriously, you should have been to this class because we're in the 12th cycle. This is some short shot shit that's going on right now. And if you take yourself half seriously, you need to get with me right now, and you at least should know what the price is so you can start making arrangements to get it. It is very important. It is shit. I always have been into shit that's going to change black people's lives. This does it. The Herb Pack will do that. Get you an Herb Pack. And if and while you're waiting to take the class because of your finances or because of your time constriction, you should be smoking a fucking Herb Pack. It is that important. So panicpack@hotmail.com. And like I said, there's plenty of baths, CDs, oils, all that other extra shit if you're in that type of if you're in that type of space. But must-haves. I'm only speaking hard on the must-haves. Class, Herb Pack, must-haves. Anything else, you can always, any supplies you need, we try to be that person for you. You know what I'm saying? Dr. Aleem El Bay, that person for you. Another thing that you must have is Orgon. Study and see what Orgon is and what it does. For instance, and again, you know by now that you can get it from our brother, good brother, Jerry Miller. Can contact him, email me, panicpack@hotmail.com. I will forward his information directly to you where you can contact him direct, or you can get at him on Facebook, search for him on Facebook, get at him, and you will see his pictures of his work he does, which is masterful. And not only is it masterful, what the Orgon itself does is incredible. So to have it in your house and it crafted in the shapes and items that he used is a must. Jerry Miller, you need to see him. And like, and y'all need to understand this. I've seen him at black shows, and people always ask him, when is this? Can I get a discount? What about this? And can I hang it on that? And this and that and this and that and the other. Because we don't really understand and know what Orgon is and how important it is. He also has to have been at white shows, the reality of this world. He said, soon as he lays that Orgon out, how much? Give me two. Because there, understand, see, but they're more urgent. They need shit like that for their transformation. We who are the conscious who are interested in transformation also do need that. We don't need it for the same reason white folks need it. We need it because we're bringing down new information. They need it to try to catch up to where we are. But understand, this is a tool that does that. It does that. And Jerry Miller sells it for an excellent price, and it's quality shit. Because there's other motherfuckers, you may see how to make Orgon on the web. Get that off your mind. Because everyone's sending me gifts all the time. Someone decided to send me how to make Orgon gift that they made online. You know what I'm saying? Now, I keep every gift. But if I took a picture of this, y'all niggas would be like, come on. Come on, son. Come on. Now, if I take a picture of Jerry, which I don't have to because he has plenty of it, scarabs and pyramids, Mayan pyramids, that's just to say the least. Charms, necklace, pendants, anything you need, he probably can craft to your specification, or his standard stuff will suit you fine. And he has different price ranges. Shit that works. Shit that this shit will undo the fucking effects of your microwave. For that reason alone, you need it. You sit in near your water and charge your water with this particular energy. That reason alone, you need. Get it. One pyramid will hold down one whole room. We have one in every room that we sit in. I have two by my computer, one in the two now because he gave me a new one. I don't know where I'm gonna put the new one. One in the living room holding them down. One in our bedroom holding them down. I might just put the new one in the guest room. We love this shit. One that I keep on my person, a small one for my pocket. Show you how mind control. And show you how his sweetheart, him and his wife, sweethearts. When you buy shit from them, I'm not going to say it's going to happen to you now. I won't get that wrong impression.
Right.
But for me. You know, but, you know, they're looking at me as a person that gives a lot in my teaching. See, y'all got to understand, I give a lot. It takes a lot to give this information. It takes a lot to talk this straight, a lot to even think this way. So a lot of people who understand that concept, they do give me stuff. Y'all do pay me back that way. Beyond the herb packs and the classes, that does help. That pays the bill, but you still get. You get what I'm saying? Because there's a couple of people panicked just trying to sell herb packs. Yeah, but you get something out of it, motherfucker. You're pioneering. Yeah, motherfucker. You get. It's not like I'm trying to sell you fucking chicken McNuggets to fuck you up. I'm selling you something that you benefit from.
Right.
I bet you ain't say that when you bought your Nikes. You know what I'm saying? And they don't do nothing for you. They don't even look that really hot. You just agree to that shit. You know what I'm saying? So this benefits from you, and it helps to keep us going. It helps me to give you information, which you must be listening to in the first place, because you wouldn't hear me ask for you to call Panic Pack to get these items unless you listen to free information anyway. Well, it's not free. It's free for you, but it changes my life. It's a lot of work to do that. You know what I'm saying? Panic, when's the book coming out? Motherfucker, I'm trying to give you a book that's going to change your life. So I'm not just trying to sell a book. If I was trying to sell a book, I just gather that shit I was writing on MySpace, have somebody do it, and have another person do it, and it's a book. In fact, just my chakra chapter alone, when Tammy did the editing of that, she said, this could be a book alone. I said, shit, that's one chapter. She said, this is so complete in detail, this could be a book alone. I said, no, that's the type of funk I'm trying to give to people who I love. The people who I feel deserve this from me, I give them no less. Why do I give them no less? If for no other reason, it damn sure ain't because what we say on Facebook, because y'all niggas is annoying. It's because y'all do support. Y'all do buy the herb packs. Y'all do come to class. Y'all getting what y'all deserve out of it, but y'all do show me love. Every once in a while, I get an email, thank you, Panic, you changed my life. That goes a long way with me, you know what I'm saying? I'm not going to sit down and pull your titties about it all day, but it makes me see, I hear you, and it keeps you make me digging hard, you know what I'm saying? Let me bring them that, let me say that, let me do this, let me do that. Otherwise, I was very content chilling by myself. I was making good money already, actually, with what I was doing at work, you know what I'm saying? I got some high degrees on my computer shit. I was always a good hustler. I could figure out something else. You know what I'm saying? Something else would have came by now. I'd have been selling something on the internet by now. Fucking random spoons or some shit. So it was never really about that. Just keeps the party going. I do appreciate it. I do appreciate the love I get. But believe you me, you need to stop patting yourself on the back, some of you niggas, because if you smoke a herb pack, it's fucking life-changing. I could sell you testimonies from niggas that cannot stop smoking, cannot thank me enough, and cannot begin to tell me the breakthroughs they had just one use of a fucking herb pack, something that I give to you offer for skinny money. Because sometimes it ain't even worth the fucking effort of some of these motherfuckers that I interface with so dirty, disgusting, and nasty. Class, motherfuckers, I see motherfuckers' entire pantheon. Niggas got houses after my class. Houses after my class. Marriages, houses, jobs, and all that human shit that they going for. And they not even going for that. They going for the occult shit, but then they see once they go for the occult shit, as some shit I've been telling you, all the human shit goes out the way. You shooting too low doing magic for human shit. You shooting too low doing magic for human shit. There was a sister who sent me an email. Oh, Panic, my mom's listening to you. She don't know shit about no computer, but she damn sure know how to get on the computer and listen to you. That's a nice thing. It goes a long way, but here's where they get. Panic, I have three questions for you. And the questions, I can't even remember them, but the shit was basically some job shit. You know, not even some job shit. How do I do that on my job? It was like it was three questions on that level. So you hear something so nice and you don't want to, and you know the real answer to that. What the fuck does that have to do with me? But you hear, how could I shit on someone who says, my mom's listened to you and it made me listen to you and I've been listening to you. Now, understand she doesn't get where I'm coming from yet. I get that. She doesn't understand where I'm coming from yet, but shit, she's listening. So I have to tread lightly and tell her. I said, well, you need to understand that I'm an occultist. What you're looking for is a life coach. You know what I'm saying? Now, I hope she could take that with a grain of sand. You know what I'm saying? And not be like, this bastard motherfucker. Understand there's a difference. Occult work is different from someone who's going to help handle your life. So what I see, we mix occult information with shit that you need life advice on.
Right.
In the class, I give you a clear understanding of the difference. But see, what you need to understand is, I don't think I've ever said it, but I'm going to say it clear. I do not frown on what you need to do to enhance your life. And I know I never said it because people say, you need to, you know, when they get nasty, you need to stop being such an occultist and get your head out the stars. And like, motherfucker, I'm the most grounded motherfucker here. You come to my house, you will never want to leave with the humanity that you will see, and that's a reality. So maybe because I never said it, so let me be clear now. What you need to do is understand human affairs belong in the realm of humanity. Your occult affairs should not be blended. So when I'm in Walmart, when I'm at Wendy's, I am the Wendy's guy. I am the Walmart guy. But you don't know me that way. And there's nothing right. you need from me in that context unless we become personal friends. You get what I'm saying? See, take, for instance, my sister, Kiana. We become personal friends. So she says, Panic, I'm having a party. Come on over. Well, what kind of cake you having, my nigga, and who made the wings? That ain't nothing occult, you know what I'm saying? There ain't no science to that, you know what I'm saying? Who made the wings? Who's the DJ? You get what I'm saying? Me and Khadija go, you know what I'm saying, party like it's 1999. The wings are pretty good. The cake is the bomb. I take a to-go plate, and we've done for the night. Then she'll come and sit in on classes. She's taking the class, sitting on class. We talk straight occult shit. What you doing with the fairies, what you did with that, blah, 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 blah. Two different things. So believe you me, there's no one who, you know, somebody, I know you walk around 24 hours, but nobody's got the time to do this. When did I fucking challenge your time to do this? Everything
exactly.
you do here
right.
is about you coming to listen and participating in your transformation.
Never.
I don't know if I come off like I hold you to a standard. Right. And I know that's the case because when I meet people, they have that face like I'm a, ask them, well, how much magic do you do, nigga? And then when they see I'm regular, then I get them, then they'll loosen the fuck up. Oh, yeah, nigga's a regular nigga. You know what I'm saying? Now, so you need to understand it's okay to do your human shit. It's okay to watch TV. It's okay to eat M&Ms. It's okay to fart in your hand and smell it. It's okay to do all of that shit because that's a human event. Just know there's a difference. Because what we seem to not know is there's a difference from humanity and spirituality. So my dreads become spiritual. My clothing becomes spiritual. I talk spiritual. Oh, yes, blessed be beloved. Now I'm spiritual in the way I talk because I said blessed be beloved. Instead of I hope you're blessed, player. You know what I'm saying? Like people say Hotep, I go, what's popping? I'm not being spiritual, but they're being spiritual because they said Hotep. That's all human fantasy, socialism. You need to understand socialism has nothing to do with your spiritual journey. Some of the baddest motherfuckers I know don't got a Facebook page. Please believe that. Please believe that. So you need to understand there's a difference. So I don't sit around and say I have not lost my humanity to occultism. The difference is what you hear me talking about is occultism. So to my aunties, to my sister, when we talk about Thanksgiving and what we're going to do, I can't talk like I talk to you. They're not fucking occultists. You get what I'm
right.
saying? So
exactly.
they wouldn't like me very much if I did what I did to you. You don't like me very much because you're a fucking human being looking for be my friend humanly, and I'm not here to be your friend humanly. Maybe that'll happen, but by God, by gum, I'm here to teach your ass something, and I shouldn't waste your time trying to fucking make you giggle on some human shit unless we on Facebook, which is a human place. That's the other side of it. How you on Facebook doing all of that? Because that's what Facebook's for, nigga. It ain't
exactly,
fucking
yeah.
Egypt. It ain't Egypt. That's what it is, to tag motherfuckers in dumbass photos. Giggle and put up dumb status messages. I put up a dumb status message and niggas is trying to decode that shit. There was one time I put up, as we go within, we go without, to see the unfolding that only starts from within, that can only fold without, as we step outside of ourselves to visualize what's only internal, which is that which was in, and what dwells within dwells without, as above, so below, which tells us only one thing. I do not like green eggs and ham. I do not like them, Sam, I am. Made of some total invented nothingness. Niggas, oh, shit, Panic, you deep. The way you be breaking shit down, son. I'm like, yeah, niggas, it's clowning yourself. And the niggas who was doing it got Blog Talk Radio shows. How about that? This ain't the general public. This is niggas y'all niggas look up to for advice. How about that? Niggas be talking to me. Same niggas called me one day. yeah, kid, the lecture you did bounced off the astral grid and reflected back. I said, what the fuck are you talking about?
Hmm.
I was like, just cut it out, yo. Talk normal, you know what I'm saying? You talk to your parents like that? Ma, you make on more cornbread? Oh, Panda's on the phone. The vibrational grid that talks back to them. Hmm. Oh, nigga, how come I get the vibrational grid? But ma, make them franks again. Ma, boil them franks for me. Oh, the vibrational grid that resonates within Panic that corresponds with the melanated force that with the crystalline dew that shoots back off the third eye classification. Shut the fuck up. Ma, did you boil the franks? Talk like that, nigga. Because anything spiritual, hear that anyway. So understand and know, you know what I'm saying, humanity, as an occultist, you don't have to lose your humanity. You just use humanity in human situations. When you're dealing with your life, you want to deal from a cult or a metaphysical perspective. So now, when humanity shows its face in our daily lives, in our daily issues, we have a magical response first. But there are some things that only merit a human response. There are certain things that only are worthy for a human response. Going to Walmart is only worthy for a human response. So now I have to put on my ritual black, my Baron Zombie hat, to go to Walmart to
right.
make the Walmart experience spiritual. That's fucking silly. So with that in mind, there are many situations you don't have to make spiritual. You don't have to make your Facebook page spiritual because it's Facebook. If you do, have at it. But it's not going to take you to the next level. It's not evolution for you. It's just your look of your social page. Oh, blessing. Welcome to my Facebook page. And I've made it the feng shui for you to come and enjoy your vision, your moment, your time in my Facebook page. Like, bitch, come on. You know what I'm saying? Motherfucker, see you for your... Like, I had Bobby's... This how you know Facebook is human. When I put Bobby's Facebook. I used to maintain Bobby's Facebook. That's when Facebook was new and everybody was communicating. He hated the shit. But I convinced him, get a Facebook. Niggas from his old town was trying to be his friend. That shit was funny. Oh, shit, Bobby, what's up, nigga? You still dress up and dance? I said, I really could go in and find out some old shit on Bobby. So I called out to him. Niggas, I said, you know a nigga named Frankie Johnson? I said, Frankie Johnson. Said, nigga, you used to dress up and dance, nigga. He said, yeah. He said, you know, I used to break when breakdance was popular, man. You know what I'm saying? I used to be dressed up with the suits and with the bow ties, and I used to be hellfire. He said, my brother was fat, though, and he used to dress up, and the whole town was calling him Hog Train. Like, as soon as you get on the dance floor, they go, Hog Train, like Soul Train. I said, this nigga used to tell me some funny shit. So I said, this is a human place. You know what I'm saying? I have two Facebooks, one for conscious folks, one I got just as many motherfucking niggas I know that I really know as conscious folks at this point, 3,000. Actually, I would have the limit. I just haven't added anybody for the last 2 years. Only people who send me emails like Panic, what's up? Because you add just anybody with the name fucking El Bay Oshun, and then they see the shit I'm doing is not as deep as they like it to be. And then it becomes, oh my God, you crass bastard, how dare you? So I only make sure motherfuckers know me. You know. So if you have a friend request for me, send me an email saying, hey Panic, you don't have to say nothing else, and I'm going to add you. You don't have to tell me no speech, say why you should be add. I don't need all of that. Just say, hey, Panic. All that shows me is that you know it's Panic. Hey, Panic, add me. All that shows me is that you know it's me. All right, I guess we're not getting cut off. So
no, not as yet.
We're going to keep going with books.
Keep going.
We're going to come back next week, Thursday. More books. We haven't ran my mouth. We haven't even talked yet. We only did 1, 2.5 shells. So I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 more shells. So we at least got at least 2 more shows if I get down to just running books. We got two more shows, but it's all good. We'll be here anyway. It's more information than just books, as you can see, and we need that. So it's all good. Dragon Time by Luisa Francia, Luisa Francia. Magic and Mystery of Menstruation. Excellent book on the power of menstruation and some of the spiritual aspects of menstruation. The Wise Wound, W-O-N-D, by Penelope Shuttle and Peter Redgrove. Another book on menstruation, one of the premier books on menstruation. Excellent book. The Goddess Book of Days, the Perpetual 366-day Engagement Calendar, the new edition by Diane Stein, S-T-E-I-N. In it, she goes, she does a calendar, like, for instance, May 19th, if that's your birthday, and she'll give out the goddesses, some gods, in certain ceremonies that are held on that day. So you can find out on your day or a specific day. So let's say something happened on March 4th, that you want to see, or each day you can look at it and say, these are the goddesses of this day, and do the and plan your day or move accordingly. Another good book, A Witch's Guide to Fairy Folk, How to Work in the Elemental World, includes a complete dictionary of fairies by Eden McCoy. This is an excellent book for those into fairy work, and she goes into detail. This is one of my favorite books on fairies. Raising Energy, she talks about how to create a fairyland. I think she does candles in here and their fairy connection. I think this is the one she does it. It may not be. She talks about different the Oakmen, different nymphs, the Oak King. She goes the Nixon, the different types of fairies. Nixers, Noddles, all these are different types of fairies. So she goes in there and she goes land of origin, like the Morse people, land of origin, other origins, other names, appearances and temperament, most active, where to find them, how to contact them, magical ritual. She goes through that through a whole, from an A to Z on fairy names. Excellent book. Okay, let's see. The Witch's Familiar, Spiritual Partnership for Successful Magic by Raven Grimassi, G-R-I-M-A-S-S-I. Excellent book. I read through it. Khadija bought this book. This is one of her shit. She fucks with all the witches and bitches. But in it, she gives you a different type of will, spells for bindings, the seal. She gives you seals to get the witch energy. The Genesis seal, different witch seals of how to become familiar with certain witches and certain energies, so then you can use them for your purpose. So the hare, the imps, the dragon, the frog, the fairy, all those things you've heard in all those movies, she's telling you their power. The cat, the bat, snake, owl, raven, mouse, imps. The vortex rituals for dissolving. She gives out rituals and all of that. Partnering with familiars, out of the Wiccan thing, but maybe a little bit one step deeper in the Wiccan thing. Okay, another movie, Dark Mysteries of the Dark Moon, The Healing Power of the Dark Goddess by Demetria George. It's a menstrual book, and it's a book, I think she also deals with moon cycles a little bit, the moon and the menstrual cycle. So another empowering book for females who have been taught in later day that the menstrual is something that they should be ashamed of, something dirty, that you'll see there's a history. Now, you can debate all day. We landed on that debate, well, at least what Bobby told me, because I never was in that fucking debate, nor did I care to be.
Right.
But Bobby was from the era of that, should women be bleeding or should they not be bleeding? And I think ultimately, Bobby came with a lot of straight, hardcore information about the mythology and the magic involving the Menses, the rites that were done based upon time of Menses and the name and all that. So you could not deny that this was happening because there was just too much history on it.
You right.
couldn't deny that it was happening. But then I think he's, well, what he did say was where it ended off was that everyone said, well, we shouldn't, the women shouldn't be bleeding as much as they're bleeding. So it wasn't about, if they should be anymore, it became they're bleeding too much in these days based upon diet or whatever.
Right.
And
about anti-feminine, you know.
Right, but now see, I have a book which we would have got to, but this is a book that everyone must have by Barbara G. Walker, and that book is The Encyclopedia of Woman's Myths and Secrets. No home should not be without this book. And she does something on the menses, which became the lecture that I did, because I did a two-part lecture on the menses. Motherfuckers are still stuck to this day on that one. And in it, she kind of walks you down from when it was deified and where it was deified throughout the world. Then she walks you down the road of when it started to become demonized through the church and through men. Men couldn't do it. So as men had to dominate, no woman could do something that a man could do and gain power from it or retain power from it, because throughout the world it was already seen as power. There was no debate. And she gives you all the places some of these things were still seen as power to this day. Based upon the child being able to bleed. Shit, the whole Holy Grail mystery is the Holy Grail, the cup that floweth over is nothing but the womb. The blood of Jesus is nothing but that fucking is menstrual blood. You know what I'm saying? When you read that Lilith book that I talked about earlier too, and understand that Lilith is the menstrual, you'll find that is basically code of how powerful the menstrual was. If you understand Lilith is the menstrual, and you hear how they deify and raise up Lilith, if you just switch that for the menstrual, then you say, then there's no question about it. If niggas is complex enough to do something, you understand? Now, another book, New Moon Rising, Reclaiming the Sacred Rites of Menstruation, yet another book that empowers women. So me, I look at what empowers women not as your attitude, even though that's not out the equation. But you can have a fucked up attitude no matter what your name is, no matter what you dress like, and be an asshole, woman or man. So that ain't got nothing to do with it. But that's just how I may feel, and your boyfriend may think you the bee's fucking knees. So that's why that doesn't matter. That's why you shouldn't hold stock if someone is saying, oh, my God, the way you talk, you're a goddess. Because it doesn't matter. Someone's going to see you as a goddess, and someone's going to see you as a fucking pain in their ass. So you shouldn't hold true to what someone's going to say. Now, from my perspective, that also means I cannot find my love or spirituality in the outside of a woman. So I can't base my love of the black woman each time I see her on Facebook and go, oh, I know you're the queen because look at your hands. I know you're the queen because look at your hair. I know you're the queen because look at your eyes and your lips and your skin. And I know you're the queen because look at the shit you said, the way you sing, and Erykah Badu and Jill Scott and Harriet Tubman. Because those things actually can be changed and conscious. Mm-hmm. To truly have a love, you have to raise up the feminine energy. And that's really,
exactly.
I'm sorry to say, is really outside of any other individual. The individual can be a representation of the feminine energy. But ultimately, in you, you have the feminine energy as a man, just like a woman has the masculine energy in her as a woman. And the feminine energy in you is what you're connecting with. So therefore, you have to study feminine energy, not females. Or you have to study masculine energy, not males, because that will let you down. As many queens as you find, 2 minutes later on Facebook, you find that some dumb black chick in the courtroom screaming about how they love chicken, and they and don't take my husband away, or some nigga dancing on Maury Povich talking about it's not my child. So you will always have an example of unqueenly and godly behavior. Then that now that says as if you find 10 niggas that are fucked up and 10 women that are queen, you have to fight in your thoughts the good perspective. That's nothing but human thought. That's human bullshit. You have to go past that by studying divine feminine energy.
First World Order Radio, finally, finally, we are on the air. No doubt. All right, all right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday is 8 o'clock. We are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.